important thing is to be realistic. We all like you here, you know that. But you're a nigger, and a lawyer is no realistic goal for a nigger.
But why, Mr. Ostrowski? I get the best grades in class. I got voted class president. I want to be a lawyer.
Now, I want you to think about something that you can be. You're good with your hands, making things. People would give you work. I would myself. Why don't you become a carpenter? That's a good profession for a color. Wasn't your pa a carpenter? Jesus was a carpenter. People like you as a person. You're doing real well. Remember what we said. Nothing succeeds like success. Let me hear it.
Nothing succeeds like success.
Since President Gerald Ford first recognized it in 1976, February has been celebrated as Black History Month. For the next four weekends, we're going to bring you stories of Black Americans whose lives and whose work are lesser known. Their contributions all the more significant because they were accomplished in the face of injustice and discrimination. Tonight, the story of a woman who helped take down one of America's most notorious mob bosses. It's part one of our series, Hidden Histories. Eunice Carter always understood the power of public service. When she was 7 years old, her parents, both social activists, fled the South after the 1906 Atlanta race riots, moving the family to Brooklyn, New York.
She was ahead of her time.
Shakayla Alvaranga is the director of public programs at the Mob Museum in Las Vegas.
Her father, William Hunton Sr., he founded the Black division of the YMCA, and her mother was a social worker, an activist, and a political organizer. And she also worked for the YMCA's war efforts during World War I. And she was one of the women assigned to work with about 200,000 segregated Black troops who were stationed in France at the time. So her family history holds a lot of depth and a lot of history when it comes to civil rights.
So this is the example that Carter is growing up in, and this is who she looks to for inspiration.
Jermaine Fowler is the author of The Humanity Archive, which highlights the achievements of Black Americans that history books have long ignored. Her family also made sure she got a good education.
She went to Smith College. She was only the second Black woman to receive a bachelor and a master's degree in 4 years in 1921. And then she entered Fordham Law School as the first Black woman to graduate from that school.
She became an assistant district attorney, mostly working in what was then called women's court, prosecuting sex workers. Her talents came to the attention of Thomas E. Dewey, then beginning his rise to national prominence as a New York State special prosecutor going after organized crime. Carter joined his otherwise all-white, all-male team.
They, you know, kind of had this unconventional relationship, but Dewey clearly knew how talented and how educated Eunice Carter was. She was out in the community, and a lot of people were talking to her. And, you know, they may have not felt as comfortable talking to the men about, you know, what they were doing.
She was paid less than her male counterparts and passed over for promotions. But her experience in women's court gave her knowledge they didn't have.
She noticed that women being arrested for prostitution from all over New York City were being represented by the same lawyers and the same bail bondsmen.
She meticulously followed the connections back to the reigning boss of mafia bosses, Charles Lucky Luciano.
Luciano is this very savvy businessman, but he's also a ruthless mafioso. And what we know of as the mafia today was started by Luciano, who consolidated these blood-feuding gangster families during the Prohibition era into one centrally supervised criminal syndicate.
After months of interviewing and wiretapping, Carter and her colleague at the time, they convinced Dewey that organized crime essentially controlled the brothels. They would pocket about $40 of their $200 weekly earnings. And in contrast, Luciano earned millions every year.
Carter spearheaded an investigation that included raids on brothels across New York City. The evidence gathered led to Luciano's 1936 conviction on more than 60 counts of forced prostitution. He was sentenced to 30 to 50 years in prison. This episode really helped establish Thomas Dewey nationwide, ran for political office. He was a presidential candidate. How much credit did Eunice Carter get in all of this?
We kind of see her overlooked, and it's really just within the last few years that we're recovering her legacy and her contributions to this case and this grand place that she holds in American history in terms of prosecution and going against organized crime.
After leaving the government, Carter entered private practice. She was active in the YWCA, the NAACP, and was an advisor to the United Nations. But it was her work in the Luciano case, helping get justice for the women he abused, that cemented Carter's legacy and earned her the title Lady Racket Buster.
She was able to really hone in and really put this case together in a way that only she could do.
We're going to pause this for the benefit of all y'all who never saw Soul Food. Soul Food is a movie about a big, humongous black grandmother, aptly named Big Mama. Big Mama demonstrates her love by feeding herself and her offspring enormous amounts of pig lard. Then, get this, Big Mama's arteries are so clogged, they gotta amputate her arm.
It was her leg!
Right, okay, whatever, leg. Then, she dies of a heart attack. Or another stroke, or something.
God called her home.
And what does the family do after she dies? They get together for a Sunday dinner and eat the same food that just killed Big Mama. The same food! They didn't learn a lesson. Nobody went on a diet, and that's the end of the movie.
Despite all the deaths from COVID in recent years, something else kills more people in the United States. Heart disease remains this country's leading cause of death, according to the CDC. So some doctors plan to team up with churches to bring medical services to people who need them most. Gulf States Newsroom health reporter Shalina Chetlani went to church.
It's daily mass at St. Joseph the Worker Church in Marrero, Louisiana, just outside of New Orleans. Louisiana, alongside its neighbors, Alabama and Mississippi, have some of the highest rates of heart disease in the nation. And black residents are more likely than white residents to experience high blood pressure. At this predominantly black church, parishioners are aware of the statistics because a lot of people here have either experienced a serious health condition or know someone who has. When people stood up for prayer requests, nearly all of them were about a child who is sick or a friend in the hospital. Parishioner Octavia Finity remembers growing up not having access to a lot of healthy food. She has diabetes and has survived cancer twice. When she goes to the doctor, she says there's often judgment and a lack of cultural sensitivity in the medical field.
I feel like the doctor does not take as much time with me as they do with maybe a Caucasian patient. So I don't feel like I get the right treatment, so why go?
There are also practical issues like lack of insurance.
Am I going to get the medicine or am I going to buy my groceries? I have to eat. So that's where we see a lot of the disparities coming.
She's a longtime member of the church's health ministry, which has been around for a few decades. The goal is to educate people on how to be healthy. They have health fairs where people learn about exercise and diet. These types of events have helped some parishioners find out they had conditions like kidney disease. That's why Tulane University doctors and public health researchers are launching a study to team up with churches like St. Joseph. Cardiologist Dr. Keith C. Fernandez is helping lead Tulane's CHERISH program, which will place community health workers and nurses in about four dozen churches across the greater New Orleans area to treat hypertension and reduce risk of heart disease within black communities. This model has worked in the past.
Probably one of the best shown examples was the Los Angeles Barbershop Study.
The Barbershop Study's results were published in 2018. It placed pharmacists within dozens of salons. It created a safe space for black men to monitor their blood pressure and get prescription medicine. And the result was that the majority of participants were able to significantly lower their blood pressure after talking to their barbers. Ferdinand says communities of color need alternatives to the hospital, like a church.
If you can see patients in a comfortable community-based environment, that may be superior to having the patient come into the hospital clinic for services.
Amen. Back at St. Joseph, Father Sidney Speaks agrees. This is a great place to monitor health.
Because it's always been a major center of community life, a center of the life of the person, the center of the family.
For example, St. Joseph has been the site of a successful vaccination campaign during the COVID-19 pandemic.
If I'm coming to church where I'm going to be spiritually made well, then that will be a place where I could be made well physically.
Speaks says he's looking forward to seeing both his parishioners and nurses come through the church doors later this year. For NPR News, I'm Shalina Chatlani in Marrero.
He was so fat. You saw how fat he was. I don't care what I brought in this house. He just eat it up. I don't care what it was I brought in here. I bring some Popeye's chicken. That boy eat the whole thing before I even get a chance to get me a bite of the chicken. He would eat his little ass off. You ain't ever seen nobody eat like he would eat candy, gumballs. He made me take him over up there to the Super Kmart. Yeah. And he put them quarters in that gumball.
Yeah.
He had to wait till he get the red gumball. He always had to get the red gumball.
You sound like a character, I guess.
With that red gumball. And he just eat all that red gumball. Hey. I was a good mother. I did every single thing I could think to do. I was really good. I was really good. I was a good mother. I didn't want her to be fat like that. I did not want my baby to be fat like that because I know a black man in America, you can't be like that. I try to.
There are lots of kid YouTubers. Some have tens of millions of subscribers and billions of video downloads. Well, a new study finds that these videos frequently showcase junk food, which raises concerns that these child influencers are actually influencing kids' food choices. NPR's Maria Godoy has more.
This is a YouTube video made by kids for kids.
Awesome!
The video features two pint-sized child influencers running around in search of soda.
Yes, soda! Okay.
This particular channel has 16 million subscribers. That's peanuts. Some kid YouTubers have more than 100 million subscribers, and they're extremely popular with young kids.
Kids as young as age 3 are spending time on YouTube.
Fran Fleming is with the Red Center for Food Policy and Health at the University of Connecticut. She and her colleagues wanted to know what kind of food and drink brands kids see when they watch these videos. So they analyzed hundreds of videos produced by some of the top kid influencers on YouTube. Turns out, food was often a co-star.
4 out of every of the 10 videos that we viewed had food or beverage branded products. And most common were candy, sweet and salty snacks, sugary drinks, and ice cream and branded toppings.
About a third of the time, the kids were shown eating the junk foods. And Fleming says that's a problem. Prior research has found that when young kids are exposed to food marketing, especially when they see someone they admire eating a product, it can strongly impact what they want to eat too and what they ask their parents to buy.
Which is something that's called pester power. And most parents or anyone who spent any time with a child knows the pester power.
Now, YouTube actually banned all food advertising on channels with content made for kids back in 2020. But Fleming says her team's findings show that hasn't stopped unhealthy foods from showing up a lot. The study didn't look at whether child influencers are actually being paid to feature those foods, and only one video out of hundreds acknowledged sponsorship. By law, such relationships must be disclosed.
Perhaps these are unpaid, but it doesn't mean that the effect is different.
Other research has found that YouTube videos often create an environment where kids can watch other kids live out their wishes. Dr. Jenny Rudesky is with the University of Michigan. She's a leading researcher on kids and digital media.
Content creators are kind of packing their videos with these highly desirable, highly pleasurable items. You know, huge pieces of candy and cake and M&Ms all over the place because they know that that gets more engagement from child viewers.
A YouTube spokesperson told NPR that they have measures in place that make it harder for creators of kid content to profit from videos that focus on food brands. Jenny Radesky says those measures are good, but her research has not found dramatic signs of improvement. Maria Godoy, NPR News.
There's nothing more refreshing than having a clear, crisp, clean glass of water on a warm summer's day.
That cool, refreshing drink.
There's a city of 150,000 people where for years residents have been periodically advised to boil the tap water. And for a week last summer, there was no reliable water service at all. It's not in a developing nation. It's here in the United States, Jackson, Mississippi. While extreme, it's not an isolated case. Last year, drinking water was found to be tainted in parts of New York City, Baltimore, and the state of Hawaii. And of course, Flint, Michigan is still coping with the effects of its lead contamination. Why are so many cities having problems with drinking water? Shannon Marquez is Dean of Global Engagement and Professor of Water, Sanitation, and Hygiene at Columbia University. Shannon, I'm just going to start with that question. Why does one of the most prosperous nations in the world have trouble delivering safe drinking water into everyone's home?
And I think this is a very complicated issue where we have a number of things that have come to a head all at one time. First, we have aging infrastructure and repairs and maintenance that have really lagged because states and local governments have been overburdened and juggling these funding priorities for a number of years. And if you think about that, that means that communities that have been historically underfunded or underserved are disproportionately being impacted. That coupled with climate change and extreme weather events and flooding are increasingly impacting water systems. And that aging infrastructure then also begins to impact contamination. So old pipes really can leach and the plumbing can corrode, and lead contamination from these leaching pipes then becomes a health issue.
This has come to a head in a number of cities that we walked through, but is this more widespread? Are there other cities having the same problem, perhaps at a lower intensity?
Absolutely. Unfortunately, we are only hearing in the news when there are these extreme events, when cities have boil water advisories. But the lack of financing to really rehabilitate old water systems means that systems have been neglected for years. So increasingly, we are going to hear more and more about this. But unfortunately, I'm afraid to say there are many, many communities who are facing these challenges right now. We're not hearing about all of them.
I know you work on water security in underdeveloped nations. Do some of the things you see in these cities remind you of the things you see overseas?
Absolutely. Many communities who are facing these challenges where there's a water emergency, they are having to plan their day, plan their livelihood, plan their life around accessing safe water and also how to deal with wastewater. And this really does mirror many of the concerns in low and middle income countries.
Is there a simple answer to explain why Americans or why cities in America have allowed the water systems to reach this state?
You know, there are a combination of things. One, communities are generally uninformed about the vulnerabilities and challenges with water systems. For example, when there's a water main break, it's usually reported in the context of a traffic disruption, not the fact that there's aging infrastructure or there are potential challenges with water quality or conveying the water as a result of that main break. Water is not a commodity that's properly valued in our country. People really take for granted that it's going to be readily available and safe, and they do not realize what it truly costs to protect water systems and make them reliable. And then I would say that environmental racism and what we're seeing with communities who are disproportionately impacted, it's quite evident since that the historical disinvestment in communities of color really mirrors the institutional racism and other barriers that have existed in our country in the troubled history.
The cities we talked about, Jackson is 80% black, Flint is 60% black, Benton Harbor, Michigan, another city with lead contamination problems, 80% black. Now, the president's been going around the country talking about his infrastructure bill. Is that going to provide any help, or is it going to be enough help?
You know, unfortunately, although this is probably the most resources and finance that have been put toward and directed toward this problem in a number of years, unfortunately, that $55 billion is not going to be enough. It literally is just a drop in the bucket, because the cost of fixing America's drinking water infrastructure will be nearly $480 billion over the next 20 years. And it's evident that the infrastructure package will not meet the full need. It's also a complicated mix of criteria that communities must meet. And that falls with the states to really decide who is going to receive and prioritize those projects. While all this is happening, because it takes so long to implement change in a water project, the infrastructure is going to continue to age and the need for investment will grow.
Shannon Marquez, Columbia University, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Can I be heard?
Missy, mommy to be.
Yeah, we're calling to report that we are officially new parents. We have the baby here with us. She was born on Sunday, so yeah, you can most likely hear her in the background.
The cries of Ravon Wells were heart-wrenching. Her son, Tyree Nichols, killed at the hands of Memphis police, was laid to rest last week. It's a hard thing to see and feel, and Black parents feel it deeply. Elaine Marsh has six adult children.
She needs that village, and I feel that we are that village.
We reached out to a few Black mothers who told us they need that village too, to help them get through the challenges and celebrate the joys of parenting. Lanice McCullough says she's loved seeing her two children develop into good people.
Listening to them grow and watching them grow, and it has to be the most rewarding thing ever to be a mom.
There's a podcast about raising Black children. It's called the Mama's Den Podcast. I asked producer Cody Elaine Oliver about her first experience of motherhood.
Me wanting to be a mom, and even my husband always wanting to be a dad. Like, we clicked on that early on. Everything was easy with our first. Now, granted, the second time we had twins.
Okay.
But with our first, there was no sacrifice that was challenging. It was just like, this is what you got to do. I also expected the worst. Mm-hmm. So anything that went smoothly or even went slightly uncomfortably, whether, you know, we got peed on or whatever, was like, well, at least we didn't get pooped on. You know, everything was like, it could be worse.
So one thing that I have really enjoyed lately with my children, who are 9, 6, and 5, I forget sometimes, is that they have these rich conversations with each other. Like, my son would be like, well, I'm going to be driving 2 years before Gabrielle, his younger sister, and then I'm not going to drive you nowhere. And she's like, what? You're not going to drive me nowhere? You got to drive. You know, like, they're just going back and forth with these conversations. Is there something that gives you that sort of joy?
First off, I love those moments too. Like, this, just listen to them sometimes say the craziest thing. I mean, girl. Well, I love seeing them be sweet to each other. Mm-hmm. We had put them to bed. It was the weekend, so they got to sleep in the same room. And I heard like a bump and silence and then crying. And I run out of my room and they're all coming into the hallway. And one of them is crying and he's holding his head. And his twin brother is behind him, but the way that his arm is outstretched, you know, like when you want to hug a friend, but you're like, are you okay? Like, it was so cute. The older brother was the culprit, so he was a little more reserved. And he's like, are you okay? Like, what is he about to tell?
Yeah,
he's gonna tell on me, you know? But the way that I watched them, like, be so curious to make sure he was okay was just, like, everything.
Oh, yeah.
I was so mad that they had done that, but I was like, oh, look at you. Don't even need me. This is adorable.
Yes. The reason why we really wanted to do this is because people focus so much on the trauma and the tragedy that Black women and mothers face. And we wanted to present a fuller picture. Like, was that one of your thoughts behind starting the Mama's Den podcast?
Yeah, absolutely. With the Mama's Den in particular, I love to share that, like, these are women that I admire and love and knew them all individually, Ashley Chia, Melanie Fiona, and Felicia Latour. And I was like, you guys, I want to hear you talk all the time about motherhood. I started it because I think that sisterhood is important within motherhood, and same for, you know, fathers as well. It takes a village. It takes a village to help. It takes a village to make sure you're not feeling alone or isolated in this journey. And that's across the board. Mm-hmm. And also to laugh and to celebrate.
What do you think about that idea of, like, obviously, you know, it's not unique that mothers would need, like, some sisterhood, some guidance, mm-hmm. but is there something unique about, like, the Black American experience that the sisterhood is a bit different? Do you feel mm-hmm. that way?
Yeah, absolutely. Plainly put, our children and us as Black adults are being hunted, are being criminalized. And we don't want to talk about that all the time. But what we do want is to recognize that in one another, that when we're talking about what school does your child go to and how's their experience, that experience is different at a predominantly white school mm-hmm. than it is at another school. You kind of don't have to have the hardest part of the conversations in any way other than to say, like, how are you doing? Mm-hmm. And how are you addressing this? And mm-hmm. what did you say to your kid about that? There's a comfort in us having those conversations amongst each other.
So is there something that you want, like, the world to know about Black mothers that you feel like is lost in some of the conversations?
I think anybody who understands the parenthood journey knows that there's joy mm-hmm. and knows that there's challenges, right? That mm-hmm. we all need to be nicer to the mama whose kids are screaming at the grocery store or on the airplanes or whatever. Like, but that the Black motherhood journey does come with that added anxiety and fear of what it means for our children to simply be brown. I want the world to understand that we are carrying that weight every day mm-hmm. through the smiles, through the highs and lows of regular parenthood, and that grace and kindness and allyship helps.
That's Cody Elaine Oliver. She is a film and TV producer and podcaster. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
I don't want us to lose sight that things are getting better. Each successive generation seems to be making progress in changing attitudes when it comes to race. Doesn't mean we're in a post-racial society. It doesn't mean that racism is eliminated. But, you know, when I talk to Malia and Sasha, and I listen to their friends and I see them interact, they're better than we are. They're better than we were on these issues. And that's true in every community that I've visited all across the country.
Turning now to the other headlines we're following right now at 5 o'clock. It circulated on social media quickly yes. this morning. A racist video featuring students at a Catholic school in Philadelphia.
NBC10's Brian Sheehan joins us live with an update. Brian, walk us through this.
Yeah, so the Archdiocese says it was made aware of the video yesterday. As of this afternoon, it's been viewed more than 500,000 times and caused outrage from organizations and the public.
We shouldn't be seeing color in 2023. What's wrong with y'all?
Community members and parents of children at St. Hubert's Catholic School for Girls are outraged after seeing a racist video circulating on social media featuring at least three students. In it, one girl sprays another girl's face black, and you hear one girl making a comment about slavery. Other girls are also heard laughing in the background.
How dare they? Something needs to be done today.
Nicole Hines is one of about a dozen who protested outside the school this morning. This parent of a former St. Hubert student says she pulled her daughter out during her junior year after she repeatedly experienced racism.
They would scream the N-word, or they would, you know, just a lot of microaggressions, pull on their hair and laugh about it, video it.
School officials condemned the actions of the students in the video, putting out a statement saying, "We are extremely disappointed to learn that anyone associated with St. Hubert's would act in such a manner, which is entirely inconsistent with our values. Please be assured that this matter is being actively investigated. All those responsible will be disciplined appropriately in accordance with our school handbook.
The question begs, when will America lose its obsession with anti-blackness, racism, and hatred? So that's what the question is, and who's going to do something about it?
The Archdiocese of Philadelphia says those students in the video are not present in school and are being disciplined appropriately.
I want justice. I want reform. They have to do something. This cannot continue.
So the Archdiocese says that for the rest of the week, students here will learn from home and all after-school events are canceled. In Holmesburg, I'm Brian Sheehan, NBC 10 News.
So when we got down there, the lunch counter was also in there, and you could smell the onion, the hamburgers, and Denise said she wanted a sandwich.
And it was kind of painful to say, no, you can't have it. She wanted to know why. And we had to tell her the sage old story about whites only can eat here, but we can't. We'll eat when we get home. She didn't understand that so hard.
That was the night that I made up my mind that I guess I had to tell her that she couldn't have that sandwich because she was black.
I guess for men it's worse than it is for women, because they are more sensitive, or I guess that's what you might call it. They hate to say, well, my child can't do what everybody else's child can do. And it makes me mad that I can't do anything about it. I can't change it right now.
Well, I want you to know that night couldn't have been any more painful than seeing her laying up there with a rock smashed in her head than to tell her that I couldn't buy her that sandwich down there because she was black. And I'm not sure she ever understood that.
How'd she react when you told her that?
Very strange, very confused, and as if a whole world of betrayal had fallen on her at that moment.
Hi, good evening to you both. The two basketball coaches at the Woodstock Academy say they stopped here at the Wendy's last night after a game, as they have done several times in the past successfully. They never expected, they say, what happened next, but they say it hurt them and their players.
Very scary moment, you know, very, very scary moment, because we've seen so many times where, you know, people that look like us we're not able to conduct these interviews after.
The Woodstock Academy basketball coaches Denzel Washington and Dante Adams are still trying to process what happened at this Wendy's in Plainfield just before 10 o'clock last night.
This is like a routine stop. It's right in the middle, you know. Not too far from the academy, so.
The coaches and the boys on the varsity basketball team just finished a tough game. They came here to grab a meal like they always do, but this time they were met with a refusal of service and a verbal assault.
Instantly, as soon as we get inside, the manager just turns away and was just like, you know, F this, I'm not doing this SH tonight, and, you know, walks to the back.
That manager has now been identified as 22-year-old Brett White of Canterbury, who has since been arrested for breach of peace. The coaches took note of White's initial demeanor and sent the team back to the bus, but they wanted to address what happened since the kids saw it and were scared. That's when Denzel and Dante say White and another worker tried to kick them out, even though there were others in the restaurant.
As we're walking out, just in utter disbelief that this is happening, you know, he's like, yeah, get the F out, you N-words. And you know, I turned around just like, whoa, like, what did you say? You know, obviously little bit different. Emotions were very different at the time. It's just like, what did you say?
A bystander heard what was happening and called police. Dante says at first he was scared for police to come.
We don't want to look like the aggressors.
But they were met by officers who listened, asked them how they felt, and took action, made possible by the detailed call from a bystander.
A special thank you to her. We're very proud of the way that our kids acted on the bus. You know, again, very respectful. It's unfortunate that they had to witness that.
Now, on top of the charges he's facing, which is, again, breach of peace, we're told that White was fired from his job. Now, this Wendy's is owned by a franchise. The company is called Inspired by Opportunity, and they sent us a statement saying, quote, they have zero tolerance for racial harassment or discrimination. They say, we condemn this manager's conduct as completely inconsistent with our values and have taken prompt and immediate action. Now, back out here live, we also did try to get in touch with Brett White in some way possible today, trying to reach out to a family member on Facebook, but we just haven't been able to reach him and have not heard back. We're live here in Plainfield tonight. Julia LeBlanc, Fox 61 News.
We call it the Coliseum. Every Sunday, they come out here and gear themselves to hit another human being as hard as they possibly can. And 75,000 people come here to cheer them on. It's all out aggression.
Kansas City is teeming with excitement ever since the Chiefs beat the Cincinnati Bengals in the AFC Championship game. Next week, they'll play in their third Super Bowl in four seasons. But KCUR's Lawrence Brooks IV reports that some fans find the controversies surrounding the team, the sport, and the NFL too much to gloss over.
The Kansas City Chiefs' unprecedented success has made them the darling of the National Football League. But many fans feel conflicted. Some feel outright alienated every time they see that arrowhead-shaped logo or the so-called tomahawk chop.
Our people were rounded up, kids stolen from their families, sent to boarding schools. Of course, in Lawrence, we had Haskell, and stripped of their culture and identity.
That's Rhonda Lavaldo, a Haskell Indian Nations University professor, Acoma Pueblo, and founder of the Not in Our Honor Coalition.
Their religion was outlawed. They could not practice their ceremonies. They couldn't sing their songs. They couldn't even say their language, because if they were brought here, their mouths would be washed out with soap. So why is it okay for the fans in Kansas City to play Indian when our people weren't allowed to be Indian?
Since 2005, Lavaldo's coalition has protested the team's use of Native imagery and traditions. She says she wants to be a fan of Kansas City football, but things like the banging of a ceremonial drum before the game make it impossible.
Your drums are important pieces to your tribe. Anytime you have a powwow, there is no alcohol allowed. You don't do that. That's sacrilege.
Matt Hofstetler is the creator of the podcast Sometimes It Rains, about the intersection of sports and social justice. Hofstetler grew up in Kansas and now lives in New York. He calls himself a lifelong fan of Kansas City football. His problems with the league go beyond native names and imagery. He says diversity among ownership in a league whose players are 75% African-American is a problem.
Especially black ownership, but really no minority ownership whatsoever in the NFL. I think if you're not getting any representation in ownership at the top, it's just going to feed down, right? And I know the Rooney Rule had the best of intentions, but I think we're seeing that it's yielding all kinds of problems, and that it's essentially a check mark, so to speak, that doesn't really require you to give any actual attention or intent to hiring black coaches. I think that's a huge problem.
The 20-year-old Rooney Rule requires all NFL teams to interview at least one minority candidate before filling an open coaching job. Then there's the issue of safety. Traumatic brain injuries have been a stain on the league since at least 2005, and the release of the movie Concussion. The film documented the league's cover-up of CTE, a degenerative condition caused by repeated brain trauma.
You can get really bad shear injuries when these happen that cause permanent neurological deficits. And the accumulation of the small ones over time ends up leading to our chronic traumatic encephalopathy.
Dr. Justin Chandler is a neurovascular neurologist at Centerpoint Medical Center in Independence, a former high school player and a diehard Chiefs fan.
It ends up leading to our memory problems, and it ends up leading to different psychiatric manifestations of concussions over time as well. And a big part of that is depression, increased aggression, right? All of these systems are affected within the brain.
A 2017 study at Boston University showed 99% of all former players whose brains were tested showed signs of the disease. Chandler says the NFL can do better.
I think that you make concussions and head trauma the tip of the spear. I think you put it out there as the number one issue in the NFL, and then I think they put their money where their mouth is. And I think that they dump as much as they can into technology, into research, into rehabilitation. Taking full ownership and responsibility of the risk is something that society will also respond to. It's a way that it also addresses the moral complexity of watching somebody go out there and take a hit for your entertainment.
When the Chiefs take the field next Sunday with another Super Bowl ring on the line, many fans will choose to ignore the moral complexity that shrouds the game they love. Others will continue to try and address it. For KCUR 89.3, I'm Lawrence Brooks IV.
Hey!
Mr. Hadley, do you trust your wife?
that's funny. You're going to look funnier sucking my dick with no teeth.
There's a new study from the Justice Department, and I'll warn you, it's about sexual assault. The study finds that prison workers who assault the people in their custody rarely face legal consequences. NPR Justice Correspondent Carrie Johnson has our report.
The Justice Department findings are based on cases where assaults by corrections workers have been reported, investigated, and substantiated.
That's a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of the sexual abuse that's happening inside of our prisons and jails.
Linda McFarland leads Just Detention International. Her nonprofit group works to end sexual abuse in all forms of detention. McFarland says most incarcerated people are afraid to report because corrections workers have so much power over them.
I've worked with sexual assault survivors in one way or another for more than 30 years. And almost every survivor who I've ever spoken to who made a report said the reason they did it was not for themselves, but so that someone else wouldn't get hurt.
But a new report from the Bureau of Justice Statistics highlights how few consequences the abusers face. Perpetrators face legal action like arrest, referral for prosecution, or guilty pleas in fewer than 4 in 10 incidents. Emily Bueller, who works at the BJS, says the study found incarcerated survivors don't get much help.
Only 36% of incidents of either staff sexual misconduct or staff sexual harassment resulted in the victim being provided counseling or mental health treatment. And in nearly 40% of incidents, there was no medical treatment either offered or provided for the victim.
In recent years, the Justice Department has investigated women's prisons in New Jersey and Florida, finding sexual violence there violated prisoners' constitutional rights and amounted to cruel and unusual punishment. Carrie Johnson, NPR News, Washington. Yeah.
I want to be a cop. Can you keep your lips sealed? I think with leadership skills can turn low-level offenders into crisp bills. You know, I've always wanted to be a cop.
Since the beginning of the year, California law enforcement agencies have been required to release records involving police misconduct, specifically discrimination. The state law, SB 16, went into effect last year, but agencies had a one-year grace period. It was designed to make policing in the state more transparent. A story by CBS 8 is highlighting some of the most egregious instances of misconduct from newly released records. That includes a San Diego police officer who was caught yelling, quote, "I kill N-words for a living. I'm a cop." KPBS editor Claire Tregesser wrote a series of stories last year based on records released under this law that revealed discrimination in the sheriff's department. She's also been digging through the SDPD records and joins us now to talk about what she's found. Claire, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
But can you briefly tell us what SB 16 requires of police departments in the state?
Yeah, definitely. So it's an additional law from State Senator Nancy Skinner that builds off her previous work of requiring records and video of police shootings and use of force incidents where they cause, the definition is great bodily injury. Those have to be released. And now this builds on it to say that records where there's been a sustained finding of discrimination, and that can be gender discrimination, racial discrimination, religious, you know, what have you, also sustained findings of unlawful arrest or seizure. So like if someone, you know, searches, a police officer searches someone's car or house or something like that, and they didn't have legal jurisdiction to do that. So those have to be released. And then additionally, when there's force use that's deemed to be, you know, unnecessary, and when someone doesn't intervene when they see a fellow officer using excessive force. So those are the new records that have to be released, as you said, at the beginning of this year, because the law went into effect, but it gave a one-year grace period.
And as you call through these documents and these records, what type of discrimination are you seeing most?
Sure. So yeah, we've been going through a lot. The San Diego Sheriff's Department began releasing records right away at the beginning of last year. And so we've gone through everything that they've released. And from the Sheriff's Department, most of the cases were more sexual harassment and gender discrimination than racial discrimination. So we saw a few cases of racist comments in the Sheriff's Department, but far more sexist comments, sexual harassment, things like that. Oceanside had one case of discrimination, and that was, again, a sexual harassment case. And that's it so far. Aside from now, the San Diego Police Department has released about 90 records just at the end of last month. All the other agencies say that they don't have any records to release.
And with that, I mean, have agencies been forthcoming with the information they're supposed to release?
It's hard to say. Most agencies here in San Diego County say that they don't have any records to release. They don't have any sustained findings of discrimination. And this is the law, so I guess we can believe them on that. The question then is, why? Is it really that there's been no discrimination among those police agencies locally? Or is it that because it takes a sustained finding for the record to be released, that means that their internal affairs investigations are not coming back with these sustained findings? Maybe they get a complaint that someone said, you know, an officer said something racist during a traffic stop, and they look into it and they decide that that's unfounded. There isn't enough evidence. And so then we just wouldn't know about that case because it didn't result in a sustained finding. Or something that I've reported on a lot previously is there's hesitancy among officers to maybe report on each other. So if they hear someone do something, they're reluctant to take it to internal affairs or file a report because they're worried about retribution. So you know, I guess the agencies are following the law, but it doesn't feel like there's, you know, that we know about all the discrimination that could be going on out there.
And this isn't the only law regarding police records. You had the story last week about the release of video showing the San Diego Sheriff's Department tasing Joe Young Jr. and igniting a lighter in his pocket, and then stomping that fire out. This video should have been automatically released, right? Why wasn't it?
Exactly. So this is an example of the law is in effect, and it says that anytime there's been an incident resulting in great bodily injury, those records and video need to be released. In this case, the Sheriff's Department said, no, this didn't result in great bodily injury, even though Mr. Young was taken to the hospital and obviously had burns on his body and was, like you said, stomped on by the deputies to try and put the fire out. And so at first they pushed back and they said, we're not going to release this record. And the First Amendment Coalition got involved. They're a legal advocacy organization. And then the records were released just last week. So, you know, this is to me an example of apparently an activist, a San Diego activist, Tasha Williams, knew about this case and asked for the records to be released. Then the Sheriff's Department said no. Then the First Amendment Coalition got involved. But if she hadn't known about it and no one else had known about it and asked for these records, it might have gone unreleased and, you know, hidden from the public forever because no one knew that it happened. And the Sheriff's Department, you know, wasn't going to release the records until someone specifically asked. So, you know, I think these new laws are helpful in terms of forcing departments to hand over these records, but they don't go all the way because if there's a case that the departments aren't going to release unless someone knows about, you know, those may never come forth to the public.
I mean, and we have people in the public like Tasha who shine a light on injustice. And as journalists, our job is often to shine that light on injustice and misconduct. Do you think this law will make it easier for us to do that?
Yes, definitely. I mean, it goes so much further than what we had before, which was nothing, basically. So, you know, now these sustained findings do have to be brought forward. And, you know, as we're seeing, we're learning about some incidents of discrimination, sexual harassment, excessive use of force, things like that. So definitely the law makes it easier for journalists to see what's happening in departments. But like I said, I think, you know, it doesn't go all the way.
And CBS 8 reported Friday on some of the discrimination records they're focusing on, highlighting some egregious behavior. Can you talk about any of those cases?
Yes, definitely. So CBS has gone through all the records that we have as well, that the police department has released, and pulled out some of the examples of specifically of racial discrimination and things that the San Diego police officers have done in the past. One of them, which is in their headline, was officers were called to the scene of someone who was drunk and disorderly. And it turned out that person was a police officer. I think they didn't know that when they were called to the scene. And then when they got there, you know, he was having a lot of issues with his behavior. He was at a motel and threatening people and, you know, picking fights with people and things like that. And then at one point during the arrest, he said, you know, I'm a police officer and I kill black people, but he used a racial slur for black people. So, you know, that's the headline of the CBS story. And that's obviously, you know, the most egregious example that's in there. There are other examples where an officer said something to a Hispanic woman about that his police dog liked dark meat. There's, you know, various complaints and examples of other racial discrimination in there as well.
And what are the implications of all this? Does this connect? Have you been able to connect the dots between this and the racial disparities that we see in use of force and even traffic stops?
Yeah, I mean, that's something that we are continuing to work on and look at in terms of, you know, we have these kind of examples of bad behavior. What does that tell us about the department overall, if anything? Or, you know, and how are officers treated when these cases happen? You know, what is the discipline? You know, what happens to officers and how seriously does the department take these incidents? So we're continuing to look at what the discipline is when things happen like these incidents, whether officers are fired or suspended or reprimanded. And that kind of gives an example of how seriously the department takes these incidents. So those are things that we're continuing to go through in our reporting.
I've been speaking with KPBS's Claire Tregesser. Claire, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
I have always been afraid of dogs. And to have the police department have dogs on us, I mean, there were people being bitten by dogs as we were trying to run away from the dogs and the fire hoses with the water that were literally washing children down the streets.
Maybe you've seen videos of them, four-legged metal machines that move and jump eerily like a four-legged creature, like a dog, only with backward knees. Robot dogs have made headlines in New York and San Francisco as those police departments added them to their forces, or at least tried to, and now that may also include the LAPD. They come from a company called Boston Dynamics, where the slogan on their website says, quote, changing your idea of what robots can do. So what will those robots do? And will they do it in L.A.? John Rigardi is a writer and reporter for L.A. Magazine, where he's been covering all things Robot Rover. And he's here with us today to tell us all about them. Hi, John.
Hey, Steve.
Describe these robot dogs. I mean, I'm trying to, they have the backward knees. I know that. They look like flamingos, I think, from the legs down. But what else do we know about these dogs?
Well, there is no fur. And, you know, one of the most interesting things is that they technically refer to it not as a robot dog, but a quadruped unmanned ground vehicle. Of course, that's cumbersome. So Boston Dynamics refers to them as Spot. And they are described as a robot dog because they, you know, they are controlled, you know, with a controller from a handler, but they do operate as an LAPD, you know, deputy chief said the other day, it moves similar to a dog, and they are anticipated to be used in certain situations where it is, you know, believed to be unsafe for officers to go, such as when dealing with a barricaded suspect.
So the LAPD has already taken this dog, this robotic dog.
The LAPD has not taken it yet, and this is where the controversy is arising. There is a proposed donation of the dog from the Los Angeles Police Foundation, an organization which supports the police department. And right now, the city is deciding whether to accept that donation or not. That's why in this recent LAMag.com article I wrote about, I described the controversy as it was going through a council committee as the committee members debated whether or not to accept the donation. Four members did say that they should accept it. One person said no. It will ultimately have to move to the full city council, but it's not within the department yet.
What was that meeting like? I can't even, I mean, we're talking about robotic dogs, right? And things are a little obviously tense between the public and the police department in a few ways. So what's going on?
Well, you know, look, as I said, if you want to spark a frothy conversation in Los Angeles, there's two reliably evergreen topics, law enforcement and animals. This brought them together. Steve, there was a long public comment period where dozens of people called in, said, do not accept this. There were complaints, you know, fears, concerns that this would lead to a, quote, militarization of the Los Angeles Police Department. There were concerns about surveillance. There were a lot of people who said, hey, this will be unfairly deployed in black and brown communities. A caller after caller urged them to say no. Now, the Los Angeles Police Department representative, you know, came in and, you know, really tried to assure people that, you know, that this is not how they're going to be deployed. You know, they said, quote, under no circumstances will SPOT be equipped with any weapons systems. They said there will not be any facial recognition software. They tried to describe the specific instances, you know, in which SPOT would be utilized. I mean, you know, to use a cliche, they plan to keep SPOT on a very tight leash if he is accepted.
Oh, yeah. These robots, John, have been donated to other police departments as well, as I mentioned, New York and San Francisco. How were they received in those places? Again, the same arguments against it?
Yeah, I mean, that we are, what we are seeing in Los Angeles is very similar to the controversies that we have seen in other cities. A SPOT type dog was rolled out in New York in 2020. But there was a fierce backlash later, and the New York Police Department had to return a device. Just in December, there was a huge uproar in San Francisco that even actually ended with the Board of Supervisors formally voting to prohibit police from allowing any kind of robot, not just a robot dog, but any kind of robot from killing a crime suspect. So, you know, what we're seeing in Los Angeles, Steve, very similar to what we're seeing in other, you know, large metropolitan cities. It exemplifies the divide between those who do not trust the department and how it uses technology and the people who are, you know, ardent supporters of law enforcement.
How would it kill somebody?
And I'm not sure how it would kill somebody. I think in the San Francisco case, they might have actually been talking about different kinds of robots. But, you know, look, I know this is, you know, a bit of a jump, but there were references to the famous 2017 Black Mirror episode Metalhead, in which there is a robot dog where, you know, it's advanced beyond what SPOT would be today. So maybe that's what people are concerned about.
The Public Safety Committee did vote 4-1 to accept the robot, right? This gift from Boston Dynamics. But it still has to go before the entire city council, right? So what does it look like going forward?
You know, Steve, what I think we're going to find out is that once it gets to the full city council, and I've not checked the agenda recently, so I'm not sure if it's coming, but I think we're going to find, again, a stark divide. We've certainly seen that, you know, Hugo Soto Martinez, a new council member, he was the lone dissenting vote before the council committee. I think we're going to find some other members of the city council who will also vote against it for the same concerns, including a lack of trust in the department. But, you know, this is a city council that even with some of the changes still probably seems like they are likely to ultimately vote, you know, in favor of this. I would be surprised if it is rejected when it does finally appear before the full council.
John Rigardi, writer, reporter for LA Magazine. John, as always, thanks for coming on and talking with us about it.
Thanks for having me, Steve.
The cries of Ravon Wells were heart-wrenching. Her son, Tyree Nichols, killed at the hands of Memphis police, was laid to rest last week.
As President Biden hosted the parents of Tyre Nichols at the State of the Union, we've been learning new details about the alleged misconduct of the five Memphis police officers accused of killing Nichols. NPR's law enforcement correspondent Martin Costi has been reviewing some newly released documents. And Martin, the terrible videos of officers beating Nichols last month have been public for a few weeks now. What new information are we learning?
Well, Juana, what we have now are more details about the conduct charges that these officers faced from their supervisors. This is an administrative process that happened in mid-January. This is basically the evidence that the bosses relied on to fire them and also to get them decertified, which is what happens to police when they lose their right to work as police officers in that state.
So can we assume that the worst allegation against them is murder?
No, not in this context. That's going to be left up to the criminal justice system where these officers are facing second-degree murder charges. This process focused on their professional conduct, or lack thereof. It found that they broke department rules by using unreasonable and excessive force against Nichols, that they failed in their duty to intervene with other officers in this excessive force and to report that accurately. Ultimately, these documents paint a picture of officers with a very unprofessional attitude.
Martin, what do you mean by that?
Well, their apparent disdain for Nichols. One detail that's already got some attention from these documents is that right after this beating, one of the officers, Demetrius Haley, is accused of taking cell phone photos of Nichols as he slumped against the police car and then texts one of those photos to other people, including non-police officers. This review also focuses on several officers for laughing and bragging about the encounter right after it happened.
Do these documents say anything about how these officers behaved, their conduct after the encounter happened?
Well, in terms of professional conduct, that's where things get even worse. In several cases, the department accuses the officers of deceit. For example, one officer claimed that Nichols tried to grab his gun. Another officer says he heard his fellow officer saying that he was trying to grab his gun. But investigators say that wasn't corroborated by the body camera video. Investigators also say that the officers did not follow the rules on how to use those body cameras. In a couple of cases, they say that the officers took their cameras off, that one of them put his camera on a car's trunk, another one put his camera inside a car.
Okay, and how serious of a breach of the rules is that, not using a body camera properly?
Well, in a case like this, it can be crucial. One of the big questions that we've been asking about this case is how it started. Why did they pull Nichols over? And apparently, the first officer to put hands on him, Demetrius Haley, he's the one we've seen aggressively pulling Nichols out of his car. He did not have his camera rolling at all at that point, so we don't see how things started.
Okay, and I understand this investigation was not a criminal trial, which may still be coming, but did the officers involved have a chance to defend themselves?
They had a chance, but most refrained from making official statements based on legal advice. The Memphis Police Association went on the record during the proceedings complaining about a lack of due process, saying that the officers didn't get a chance to see all the evidence against them, including some video. One officer, Justin Smith, did submit a written statement in which he says that Nichols was, quote, actively resisting, and that he was just there to assist in the arrest and followed the training he'd gotten from the police department. I think as the criminal prosecutions get going here, what we're going to see is more sort of a fine point being made about which officer did what and when.
NPR's Martin Costi, thank you.
You're welcome.
Turn off the lights, light a candle.
Now let's focus on increasing attacks by extremists and others to disrupt and knock out the power grid. Direct attacks on electrical substations, including vandalism and other suspicious activity, were up by nearly 80% in 2022 compared to the previous year. Yesterday, authorities said they had foiled an alleged neo-Nazi plot to attack multiple substations and transformers around Baltimore. William Brangham has the details.
The FBI said it had arrested two suspects in this case last week, Sarah Beth Clendaniel of Maryland and Brandon Russell of Florida. Federal officials say Russell, who was just released after a five-year sentence on bomb charges, is a founder of a neo-Nazi group known as the Atomwaffen. This alleged plot in Baltimore follows recent physical attacks on electrical stations in North Carolina, Oregon, and Washington state, attacks that left tens of thousands of people without power. Motives in all those cases haven't been determined. Brian Levin watches all this at the Center for the Study of Hate and Extremism at California State University in San Bernardino, and he joins us now. Brian Levin, thank you so much for being here. Last year, the Department of Homeland Security indicated that racist extremist groups would be targeting infrastructure, very much like this alleged plot in Baltimore. Can you help us understand why would neo-Nazis want to attack a power station? How does that further their goals?
Couple of things. First of all, historically and culturally, infrastructure plots and attacks and the glorification of it within various books throughout the movement and prior plots goes back decades. Some decades ago, I testified before Congress about something called leaderless resistance. And as the far right frequently throughout history and especially today has become very fragmented and cellular, these kinds of targeted attacks that can be done by lone actors or small cells is very appealing because it gives them leverage with respect to their small numbers. So we have both a historic sociocultural identification of these locations as legitimate targets in an overall racial holy war or civil war, or as accelerationists want to do, just burn down society. These folks are looking for some kind of chaos. And what they were hoping is there'd be some kind of violent conflict around these attacks, or as in some of these plots most recently, attacks that take place around already emergency situations like snowstorms or natural disasters. So what they hope to do as part of the accelerationist wing of neo-Nazism, but that actually goes across the ideological spectrum, is to cause chaos and continuing lack of confidence and in institutions and infighting among citizens. And they figured these kinds of targeted attacks, assassinations, and violence at rallies could combine to create that critical mass of revolution for white supremacy.
I see. This Baltimore plot, along with these others that we've seen in Washington State and North Carolina and Oregon, seem to indicate, though, that these power substations are themselves particularly vulnerable. Is that your understanding as well?
Well, I prefer not to go into particular vulnerabilities of specific locations, but let me just say this, is we know that the protection of various substations and related facilities is very uneven across the country. And we really have to raise the national standards, not only with respect to physical attacks, but also cyber attacks, which may not only just come from white supremacists and accelerationists, but others who either are connected to a foreign entity or are transnational in their white supremacy, not necessarily exclusively domestic. And indeed, Adam Waffen and some of these other groups had international footprints. So we have to look at not only the physical infrastructure, but also cyber as an increasingly available set of malefactors is available to want to hit our critical infrastructure.
So given those vulnerabilities that you're describing, I mean, what would you be recommending that governments and utilities be doing to help harden these pieces of infrastructure?
I think they have to look from within. I think they have to go to the experts that are working there and say, what are our vulnerabilities? Even do some drills where folks might try to, with proper vetting, try to show where these vulnerabilities are. So that's one thing. The other thing is increasingly surveillance systems are becoming much more inexpensive. So we have to look at that as well. And again, don't forget the cyber infrastructure. We know from the past that, for instance, there have been attempts to breach, for instance, critical infrastructure here in the United States, from water systems to hospitals and other places where we rely on them for our safety, but also our routine daily activities. So anything, frankly, that would be a vulnerability for some kind of mass chaos. I think communities have to look at, and of course, communication systems, electrical infrastructure, healthcare systems, and others are places I certainly would start, as well as cyber infrastructure. Really important.
All right. Brian Levin, the Center for the Study of Hate and Extremism. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Turn them off!
The criminal investigation into who attacked the power grid in Moore County is still going. Experts tell us the incident will hopefully have a massive ripple effect, boosting security for the power grid for years to come.
You're going to see companies make more security recommendations. I think you're going to see that energy companies are going to have to look at more ways to secure their assets.
The attack shining a light on just how vulnerable the power grid is. Ever since, lawmakers like Governor Cooper and Congressman Richard Hudson have been looking at reforms like strengthening infrastructure, grid resiliency, and supply chains. They're also exploring issuing steeper penalties for anyone who compromises the power grid. The Moore County Sheriff's Office has been offering $75,000 as a reward for information that leads to the conviction of the person or people who attacked Duke's power grid, an attack that left 45,000 people in the dark for almost a week. However, even though this devastated thousands of people in the area, a spokesperson for the North Carolina Department of Insurance says there is support.
We're here to support you. Department of Insurance is wants to work with anyone that has a special circumstance and is willing to listen and, you know, be an advocate and, you know, help you make your decisions.
The DOI has launched special services to delay premium insurance payments, offer food spoiler support, and expand special enrollment to those in Moore County impacted by the power grid attack. I'm Monique John, ABC 11 Eyewitness News.
Because I'm pointing out the tremendous corruption that's taken place in Baltimore and other Democratic-run cities. All you have to do is look at the past mayors in Baltimore, see what happened. No, I think I'm helping myself, and I'll tell you what. The White House and myself and letters and emails and phone calls have received more phone calls than I think on any other subject of people from Baltimore and other cities corruptly run by Democrats thanking me for getting involved. Those people are living in hell in Baltimore. They're largely African American. You have a large African American population, and they really appreciate what I'm doing, and they've let me know it. They really appreciate it.
All right, until then, tonight we are learning new information about the Florida man who right now is at the center of an FBI investigation into a plot to destroy Baltimore's power grid. And this is the same man connected to a murder investigation in Tampa 6 years ago. So just a few hours ago, federal investigators, they announced that they have arrested Brandon Russell, and they say he and this Maryland woman named Sarah Beth Clendaniel plotted to shoot energy substations north of the Baltimore area.
He described attacking the power transformers as the greatest thing somebody can do. In her own words, Clendaniel said she was determined to do this. She added, it would lay this city to waste. Their actions threaten the electricity and heat of our homes, hospitals, and businesses.
The FBI says that one of their sources actually alerted them to these plans. Now both are behind bars. I want to bring in 10 Tampa Bay's Liz Crawford. She spent the day digging in on this story. And Liz, it turns out Russell has ties to this 2017 double murder that happened here in Tampa.
Yeah, so at the time, the murder scene was the focus. In 2017, Devin Arthurs confessed to killing his two roommates. He has yet to stand trial due to competency rulings. But the double homicide led investigators to Brandon Russell. Now, according to an affidavit written by an FBI agent, when Tampa officers showed up at the apartment to investigate the murders in 2017, Brandon Russell was standing outside the front door crying. He was the fourth roommate at the house, and according to Arthurs, all four men shared neo-Nazi beliefs. Arthurs said Russell had been on neo-Nazi chat rooms for a while and threatened to kill people and bomb infrastructure. TPD searched the residence and found bomb-making materials. Inside Russell's bedroom, they also found Nazi propaganda and a framed picture of Oklahoma City bomber Timothy McVeigh. Now, ultimately, Russell was sentenced to 5 years in prison on bomb-making charges. The FBI says while in prison, he started talking with the woman he was conspiring with to take out the Maryland power grid. Liz Crawford, 10 Tampa Bay.
white girl going through my mind. Sarah Jack and Julie too. White girl, Julie Jack and Sharon. Tell me it's a 5 o'clock.
That's right.
He don't wanna know what's going on. Cause white girls won't go away.
Only on WJZ, the mother of the suspected extremist behind an attack on power substations across Baltimore is breaking her silence. What she says about her daughter and the foiled plot. Hello, everybody. I'm Denise Koch.
And I'm Vic Carter. Welcome to those of you watching on CBS News Baltimore and on WJZ TV. The FBI spent months monitoring two suspects with neo-Nazi ties as they planned an armed attack on critical power substations.
Well, tonight we begin with a revealing interview with the mother of Sarah Clendaniel, who faces decades in prison if convicted. Federal prosecutors say Clendaniel and a friend wanted to destroy the power grid and plunge Baltimore into chaos. They say the plot was fueled by racially motivated hatred.
WJZ investigator Mike Helgen is live in Cecil County, where Clendaniel grew up. He has her mother's first television interview. Mike.
Vic, Denise, the U.S. attorney says if this plot had become reality, it would have been catastrophic and life-threatening for people in our area. Now, her mother tells me she spent time with her daughter over the holidays. She knew about her extremist views, but never suspected this plot.
Unless there's a miracle, she'll most likely die in prison.
For the first time, Lynette Clendaniel is speaking publicly about her daughter, Sarah, who prosecutors described as a neo-Nazi who was plotting to blow up the power grid in the Baltimore area.
Our views are different, and she knows what I believe, and I knew what she believed, and, you know, we just didn't
Are you
discuss
shocked?
That. So, no, I'm not.
Would you say that she's a Nazi or neo-Nazi, that it's true that she held those views?
Yes, she definitely held those views.
Is there anything, did you try to reason with her or talk to her about it?
My philosophy to everyone in the world is watch Independence Day and get a grip. We all live on this planet together. You better get along.
She says Sarah, who grew up here in Northeast, has had trauma since early childhood and 7 years ago served jail time for robbing local convenience stores with a machete to feed a heroin addiction.
She really has always had anti-establishment views.
She tells us that time behind bars escalated her daughter's extremism. It's also where she met Brandon Russell. Prosecutors say he's the co-founder of Atomwaffen Division, a neo-Nazi organization who recently served prison time for possession of bomb-making materials in Florida.
She had mentioned him, but like I said, I didn't discuss her life. She knew I didn't agree with it, so we really didn't go there.
Her daughter had been living with a friend in Catonsville. Chilling images in court records show her armed. Prosecutors say she was terminally ill and determined to carry out her plot before she died, and was recorded telling an FBI informant, "If we can pull off what I'm hoping, this would be legendary." Do you think she was capable of carrying out a plot like that?
I think the last time that she was here was mostly spent in bed the whole time, and then trying to spend a little bit of time with her kids.
And are you going to be there in court to support her, or what are you going to do?
Most likely not. I'll probably be here with her children.
She now has custody of her grandchildren and shared this picture of her daughter at a 2005 Grand Canyon trip, and says she always liked to live on the edge. Lynette says she'll rely on her faith to get through what's next.
My Heavenly Father has His plan and His purpose for all things. And whatever His plan is, so be it.
And prosecutors say this plan was detailed and had been in the plotting stages since June. Clendaniel is represented by the public defender. Live in Cecil County, Mike Helgren, WJZ.
Before she got to the part where she said that she's going to put it in God's hands, Sarah Beth Clendaniel's white mother said, you know, I think we all just need to watch Independence Day, get a grip, try and live on this planet together. That old smacking heathen Will Smith, what is he going to teach me about brotherly love? That film is 25 years old, moldy as all, and then I got to sit here and watch Will Smith smacking people for 2 hours. Smack old Chris Rock upside the head, then smack the aliens around. He did that in the movie, too. Remember that? He smacked them in the head. What's that going to teach me about anything? Don't put it in God's hands. That's what they said on the job yesterday for workplace racism. They said, we can't fire the white man, so we just going to pray on it and put it in God's hands. Hope. Learn that from Obama. Woo! Compensatory call-in. What to do? Gus T. Renegade in for another call-in, hopefully, to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Saturday, February 11, 2023, so I have been told. 14 years, context of white supremacy. Cannot believe it. This time, 14 years ago, we were getting ready to speak with Chet Detlinger about his book, The List, The Atlanta Child Murders. I cannot believe it that is still relevant. I just literally went back and referenced that program last year. Someone asked me literally months ago, they said, Gus, how exactly did you know about Joseph G. Christopher and all those crimes in Buffalo? And I said, Program 1, Chet Detlinger, he talks about those Buffalo killings in his book. Can't talk about the Atlanta crimes, so-called Atlanta child murders, without talking about Buffalo. They happened at the same time. And the Atlanta youth murders and the politics of race, that book also mentions the Buffalo crimes. That's how I knew. 14 years, that is... There are very few things that I have done in my life that I can look back on more than a decade later and say, dang, that is still relevant. Maybe even important beyond just being relevant. 14 years, context of white supremacy. In our 14 years, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing, Program 2... author of the ISIS papers, 31-time guest, Dr. Welsing's sister, Lorne Cress Love, just passed away. She was a guest on this program 3 times. We talked about her own, Lorne Cress Love, her own record of counter-racist efforts. Certainly her relationship with her sister, Dr. Welsing, their amazing family to produce all of these children, and just really, you can go back. I posted her very first visit from 2016, which I think is a couple days into the Trump presidency, but I posted that online today. Check that out. But certainly, we will take a pause. Lorne Cress Love, victim of white supremacy, for her transition. Context of white supremacy. The great Lorne Cress Love. One thing I will say, like, wow, I don't know if that's genetics or if they, you know, I mean, hey, 3 generations of doctors that, you know, might have an impact as well. But they didn't exactly, Dr. Welsing and Lorne Cress Love, they didn't exactly, you know, die early. It seemed like they must have been doing something to try to eat correctly. Get some exercise, get some rest. I don't know if Lorne Cress Love, I don't know if she was out partying every night, staying out till 3 o'clock in the morning. I got to be the last one, close the bar down every day. Like, I don't know. I could be incorrect, but I think maybe some investment in trying to take care of themselves so they could do constructive things be on their assignment. I would say mission accomplished for both. They were on their job. Dr. Welsing, for sure, Lorne Cress Love, for sure. Check the archives if you forgot or didn't even get to hear. When she was here, she had lots of great details to share about her sister as well. Let's see. We will be here tomorrow. Dr. Welsing. She was with us 31 times. Importantly, she was with us multiple times on the Super Bowl. In fact, I think she was with us for the Super Bowl in 2015. I have to go back to double check to be certain, but I think she was. Wow. Anywho, which is even more wacky because I think that would be the Super Bowl where flipping Tom Brady beat the Seattle. Worst day ever, but and which I wasn't even watching because we were talking to Dr. In fact, fun fact. A cow's listener contacted me for mockery and ridicule. Thought you all were going to repeat your loss. You and Russell, well, you're a loser. You're a loser. Didn't you? Why did I say that? Well, no, I didn't even really know the score or anything because I was talking to Dr. Welsing. I didn't think I could concentrate and do both. He was like, oh, yeah, that's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. Dr. Oh, dang, so you didn't even. It's like Dr. Welsing was here for the whole program. So, no, I did not watch the game. No, I was not aware of all of that. But, yes, we did not win. Defeat. Oh, well. Anywho, we will be here tomorrow. So, we'll get opportunity to do the same thing. Like Gus T. Renegade Heathen is doing it like he knows what he's doing. They, Boston University, their School of Neuroscience up in New England, they released the report this week. Not that we needed another report, but they gave us another one that old tackle football, I think like 92% of the players, I might be rounding up, but not by a bunch because it was way over 90%. So it was like 92, we'll say, had CTE specific, so I can even show off what I've learned since we've been talking about this. So approximately 92% of the NFL players that they studied had chronic traumatic encephalopathy. Approximately 8% did not. The pause is you can have brain damage that is not CTE if you play tackle football. So, that 8%, it's not that their brains work well, it's just they don't have CTE official. All the rest of it, oh yeah, you probably have to. The lamest use of time and energy. Maybe, just maybe, not that I want to hear anything about entertainment. In fact, delete what I was even going to say. Lamest use of time and energy. I would not allow your offspring to watch that activity tomorrow or really anything associated with it. Now, that's going to be challenging. Might be a good day to go hiking, like all day long, so that you're not in front of the screen or other people that go out and do all their partying and drinking and all the wagering. Might be a good day, go out, get some exercise, enjoy the, it's almost spring. It has been, it was sunny, like it would have been beautiful. If the weather is like here in Seattle, if the weather tomorrow is similar to what it was today, Saturday, you could be out all day, have a grand old time, even have a picnic and miss all of that goofiness. Anywho, to do our part to assist, we are resuming our tradition tomorrow, and this was planned. Oh, planned so beautifully. So they released that study this week. Bang, like, ooh, and they even, I saw several reports, so they said, ooh, I'm sure the NFL did not appreciate this time, and like, they're getting ready for the big brain damage bowl, and ew, another study to show that, yeah, this is kind of dangerous, pretty much. It's not possible to play this safely. You're going to damage your brain. And since 75, in fact, they are bragging this week about, it's black male quarterbacks. Isn't that great? What do you think, Doug Williams? Isn't that great? A bunch of black males to get brain damage. Yeah, that's awesome. Wonderful. Played in a state where they didn't even want Dr. King's holiday. BBC had a great report about how Arizona lost a Super Bowl because they were so staunch in their opposition to Dr. King's holiday. John McCain, the great veteran. Much obliged, good sir. Anywho, we'll be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, like we planned it, talking with a white neuroscientist about brain damage and racism, like he planned it. I did. In fact, I was so surgical in picking that date for this program. The two top dates that I told our guests were, let's do it on Dr. King's Day, or let's do it on the Super Bowl. She picked the Super Bowl. 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. That might be halftime. I don't even remember who's performing, but won't be Dr. Dre and company like last year. Remember that? The Chronic? The whole culture of the NFL. Matter of fact, the whole culture, when they did that report and they talked about the violence of Kansas City, when they do the chop and all of that, man, the one thing that they left out, I don't even live in Kansas City. The one thing they left out, I remember this one from, what is that, last year? Was that last year? 2021, that's what it was. The New York Times, what any parent would do. Britt Reed, son of NFL coach, sentenced for drunk driving crash. I'm skipping down a little bit. The distance from the Kansas City Chiefs training complex to Interstate 435 is short. It would have taken Britt Reed only moments on February 4, 2021 to drive from the facility where he had been drinking to the highway's on-ramp where his pickup truck reached 83.9 miles per hour before it rammed into two stopped cars and seriously injured a five-year-old girl. When Reed was sentenced on Tuesday to 3 years in prison for one felony count of driving while intoxicated with serious bodily injury, his father and former boss, Kansas City Chief Andy Reid, was not at the courthouse. Britt Reid, who had asked to be placed on probation, was immediately taken into custody. The sentence was another episode in the troubled journey of Britt Reid, 37, a one-time NFL assistant coach who has battled drug addiction, as has his older brother, Garrett, who died at age 29 in 2012. For the Reed family, football has been more than a vocation. Andy Reed's children had been coming to his training camps since they were very young, and his three sons and a son-in-law have worked for him at various times. They call that nepotism. Dick Vermeil, the Hall of Fame coach in Reed family friends, said Andy Reed did what any father would do for his children, troubled or not, love them and give them an opportunity. Nepotism. Britt Reed's crash, the handling of the case, and a previously unreported assault have called into question whether Andy Reed's football ties and goodwill have protected his son at the expense of others, especially five-year-old Ariel Young and her family. Britt Reed became addicted to painkillers at 14. At 14. At 14. Jesus Christ. What? You sit there and wag your finger in our face, crackhead, this and chronic that and painkillers at 14. Was arrested twice in his early 20s and spent 5 months in jail. A couple of months before his crash in 2021, according to a police report, he got into a road rage incident with an off-duty law enforcement officer, punched the officer's driver's side window, but wasn't prosecuted, an episode that hasn't been previously reported. I'm gonna stop here. It almost slipped out of my mouth. I almost said this nigga was employed with the Kansas City Chiefs. Because that's really what I was thinking. I was going to say it that way, but this suspected racist was employed with the Kansas City Chiefs at the time of this crash where he hit this 5-year-old. I don't even have what. That's what I mean. Like, now, that report that we heard talking about the Kansas City Chiefs and I'm conflicted about football, like, they included a lot of information, even though they did do what they standard do, the intersection of football and social justice. That's counter-racist media literacy. They always, always avoid racism, white supremacy. Nah, we'll find any way to say anything but that. That whole, you all don't remember that? I remember that. That was a big deal. Right after the Super Bowl. You all don't remember that? How did they not include that in the segment about, what do we really think about Kansas City Chiefs culture? Painkiller. So, if his children, I'm just being retarded for a moment. Can I be retarded for a moment? So, if his children, Andy Reid, white man, if he's been bringing his children around, and Andy Reid used to coach for the Philadelphia Eagles. How about that? They've made a big to-do about that this whole 2 weeks. So, if he's been bringing his white offspring around tackle football since they were born, and many of the players, Brett Favre, many of the players end up being addicted to painkillers and or having to take lots of painkillers for all that brain damage and other damage to your body. Is that part of the culture? Maybe his children absorb being around football? Am I being retarded? You can let me know, Gusty, you're being retarded. I might ask the neuroscientist tomorrow, but that seems like that's a part of the football culture. Take a shot, alcohol, take a shot, take a drink, take a shot, drink a drink, take a shot, mean that both ways, with the needle shot and then tequila shot. Take a shot, take a drink, take a wager, take a shot, take a drink, brain damage, take a shot, take a drink. Okay, I mean, I'm being retarded. And wait a minute, so if that was Leroy, if that was Antonio Brown, if that was Jalen Hurts, if that was Pat Mahomes, and he has a white parent, he got into an argument with an enforcement officer and punched the driver's side window. You think they would have reported that? Black male privilege, right? That's what I'm told. You think they would have reported that? I would pick a black coach, but they don't have black coaches in the NFL. Wah, wah, wah. So tell me, you all think nigger male? They're really good. Bron James, he gets stopped under the influence. You think, let's skip the whole prosecution part. We'll leave that alone. You think that doesn't get reported? In fact, LeBron James and all that doesn't count because Britt Reid is a nobody. He's not even the coach. There would have to be one of LeBron James' like lackeys or somebody. Would have to be like one of Kobe Bryant's lackeys or somebody. Pat Mahomes' lackeys or somebody. Now, really? Really? So now we're not even talking the star. It's one of the star's lackeys, family members or whatever. You think they could go out and do all this and it wouldn't be reported? This fella is a recidivist. Isn't that the word? You can let me know if I'm retarded, because I didn't even know penile graffiti, so, you know, still learning. But isn't that it? A recidivist. What they call a repeat offender. Penalty's supposed to be worse, isn't it? This is not your first time. You have a pattern of criminal misconduct, so you need to learn your lesson. Not for the white man. I've heard that before. Anywho, the number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. The number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Man, absolutely incredible. A five-year-old. I remember that live time then. A five-year-old. He could have killed her. Anywho, we will be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. We will also be here on Monday, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. White guest, kind of an accidental find, but I'm talking to a white person. We'll be looking at white person and even talking about education specifically. White people conspiring to practice racism. Looking forward to that one. But And this is, I think, one of the only times I am asking in advance for a racist joke. In fact, I requested, I said, I always ask white people for a racist joke, and you're in a so-called southern state, and you're saying that your family members are racist and all this other stuff, so you for sure have heard some racist jokes. She says, I don't even, you can just think of a good one. He said, so do you mean like my friend had the monkey lamp and I had to go in and say, whoa, you got the monkey lamp. What is going on here? What are you doing? Planet, come on. We can't do Planet of the Apes with the monkey lamp. I didn't even know that they make monkey lamps. I'm still learning. Monkey lamps. I said, you can tell us about the monkey lamp, that counts, but I'm sure you can think of a really good racist joke. But you can tell us about the monkey lamp, too. I'm always down for Planet of the Apes. Any hoodles, let us see. In our 14 years, one thing that I can say, a pattern I've observed, and I think it's a part of our victimization, brain trashing, television, streaming, all of that is such a powerful force that comes up in the book club so frequently. For this program, I have asked for years that we not talk about Area 8, Area 3, entertainment and sex, because we talk about these all the time, and especially entertainment, like gee whiz, like that. That cannot be the most important thing to talk about. What was on television? What did we stream? What did you see on that? That cannot be the most important thing. That is way, way overemphasized. Many other things to study seriously. And we don't even study most of the time. It's just watching. Get the popcorn. That's most of what it is. I've said that for years. It is amazing how resistant, like you have to beg, can we please not talk about television? Can we please not talk about entertainment? Can we please not talk about entertainment? People are watching TV right now. It is such a powerful force. Even people that have heard and recite Dr. Welsing, reading is more important than watching television. That's why make sure your offspring are not watching that game tomorrow. That should be a rule. They talk about things that are addictive. Woo. And there's so many addictive things around that game, maybe even painkillers. How about that? For sure, alcohol. I mean, how much of a stretch is it really? Every other commercial is for liquor, so I mean, Coors, remember that? I just talked about that, Coors, the wetbacks and the negras, and let's see, I will get in two quick comments and then we can get to War 3, we'll get to the folks who dialed in. Number one, the report where they talked about the robotic quadruped that they're calling Spot Boston Dynamics on whether LAPD, Mark GED Furman, are they going to get one of these robots, devices to use? And so they said, well, how would it be armed? He said, well, I'm not really sure, you know, that's talking about. He says, well, theoretically, it could be Black Mirror. Now, we did talk about Black Mirror with Dr. Kevorkian. Talked about that episode specifically with the black dog hunting the white woman. But we don't need Black Mirror for that. In fact, even before that episode of Black Mirror existed, Micah Xavier Johnson existed and was killed by one of those robotic devices in Texas. They equipped it with an explosive device and killed him. First time, they said they didn't even know if that was legal because it had never happened before. But that went down summer of 2016 in the middle of a presidential election. But I just thought you could take a lot of picks there, like sloppy journalism, racism, white supremacy. I mean, other people who have talked about robotics and policing, that is an important case. I mean, number one fatality with the use of a police robot device of some sort, to my knowledge, unless I'm been misinformed, but that's the way that I've heard other white experts report that incident. First time that it ever happened. That's what it should be, not some flipping Netflix. Come on now. Or yes, blackmail privilege. Yes, blackmail privilege. Two, the segment where they talked about the PBS, where they talked about the attacks on the power grids, they used that term again, accelerationists. I first heard that, I think, last week. And I think some other people, they said, accelerationist? Have you heard that before? And he said it again, but as opposed to using that as a replacement for white supremacy, this was just used as accelerationist white supremacists. It was connected directly in the PBS report and saying that these people, they want to speed up some sort of acute violence. What I said last week, we want an opportunity to kill black people, especially non-white people, we being white people, racist man, racist woman, racist child. That's what we want. Power goes out, all that. We stocked up our guns. Let's get to it. Got it. Wow. Wow. And even within that, in addition to accelerationists, which is a new term that I've been hearing, they had transnational white supremacists. And that was explained as, we have our domestic terrorists, right? Sarah Beth Clendaniel, homegrown, as they say. You have white people who don't even live here, who are engaged in racist terrorist plots to disrupt infrastructure. Wow. Now, it is a global system, but I mean, dang. Keep all of that in mind as we proceed. White people do network worldwide, especially for, you know, usual purposes, maintaining, expanding, refining the system of white supremacy, racism. They even mentioned that the term in that report that get a critical mass of these folks who are engaged in this disruptive content with the power grids and what have you. Like, dang, we talk about getting a critical mass of counter-racists. They're trying to get a critical mass of race soldiers. Go out here and do some more devilment. Kill some non-white people. Let's see. With the attacks on the power grid, I don't know why that is not domestic terrorism. Everything that they've said, you're knocking out heating to houses. It's the middle of the wintertime still. Many people with medical concerns, they need electricity to live. Why is that not domestic terrorism? Highest charge, the same way they're talking about these black identity extremists and all that. Like, hey, you already know what's going to happen, buddy. Incidentally, they got that fella, Brandon Russell, down in Florida. Can you imagine? They said he was down there plotting murder in Tampa. They had an attack on the Tampa power grid as well. I talked about that earlier this year when we were bringing up some of the attacks on the power grids. They had the one down in the Tampa area. Matter of fact, the report from Tampa Bay Times, this is not new. Tampa Bay substation break-ins reveal power grid's vulnerability. Several Florida substations were burglarized in September, according to a Duke Energy report filed by the Department of Energy. The burglars shut off power to homes in Pinellas and Pasco counties. Maybe that was Brandon Russell, too. Come on, man. Like, these white people are out doing all kinds of, that's the same thing. Like, for real, he's been engaged in all of this. You monitor prisoners' mail and all of this. How is he in prison fomenting attacks? Like, are you serious? Come on, man. You got to tell me a whole lot of things. And the white woman at the end. I think that's so important. They give us so much about the white male supremacy and white male patriarchy, as though all of this just happens with white men. You had a no count white trifling white mother who was prepared to dump her children and everything, and they're saying that she allegedly had some sort of medical condition, as opposed to standing home. I'm invalid, frail, we stay with my children, these are my last days. Nah, get these niggas in Baltimore. Like, what? Come on. White people, their brain computer does not operate the way non-white people's does. They do not think the way that we do. Who is thinking in that manner? I got what's on my so-called bucket list with a month to go. You know what? We are going to stick it to them. Where are we going? We're going to get them folks in Salt Lake City. I got a grievance, and we're going to get this settled. You don't want to spend time with your family? And we're going to get them folks in Salt Lake City. We'll get to them later. Maybe we'll have a slice of sweet potato pie, but we're going to get them folks. Matter of fact, they said, this will be the greatest thing I've ever done. Not having children, not being a mother, not making good sweet potato pie. Nope. We're going to put them niggers in the dark. This is going to be the real blackout. Are you serious? Yes. You should talk to your offspring. Florida, they didn't even name enough of the states. I said, man, I have given a longer list myself without doing a whole lot of access and research and team help go in and investigate all these different cases. Florida, Oregon, Washington State, North Carolina, South Carolina. Now you can put Maryland on there as well. Arkansas, like, it has been rampant. I think Texas is on there too. It has been rampant. That's not even the complete list. What does it mean to be white? And Timothy McVeigh, he was selling the Turner Diaries again. This is in the Turner Diaries. Let's go hit the electric station, pull out the power grid, cause chaos. We can go kill the dark people, the mud people, as they are referred to in the book. Just been talking about Timothy McVeigh. I didn't even understand him as a racist. I just thought, wow, crazy white man. It's all crazy white man. Race soldier. Timothy McVeigh. Race soldier. Jeffrey Dahmer. Race soldier. Gary Ridgway. Even get my correction from yesterday. Gary Ridgway, the so-called Green River killer, super disproportionate number of his victims were non-white, said he was first arrested in the early 80s for domestic violence. Strive for accuracy. It was for prostitution. That's who he was killing. Not domestic violence, although he did allegedly engage in domestic violence as well. He just didn't get a criminal record for that. But strive for accuracy. But even Gary Ridgway, race soldier, killing lots of non-white females in an area where there are not lots of non-white females. Alrighty, number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. press star 61 if you would like to participate. Let us see. First few folks who dialed in with a hand up, you have commentary to share. Proceed.
Hello, Abby here.
Greetings, Irie.
Otep. Hello, Gus. My cat apparently wants to say hello to everyone, too. He's loud as ever. I don't know if you can hear that. I think I have something constructive that parents can do for kids whenever they don't think that they have something to do, or, I mean, if they're just looking for something literally constructive and possibly life-saving. Start a project on fortifying your home or creating systems in the home that will allow you all to thrive if the lights go out, if there's no food, you know, so, you know, gardening, indoor gardening, or if you have space outdoors, just getting maybe into electrical engineering just a little bit, like finding ways to, you know, connect solar panels to the house. I have a friend who had a girlfriend whose son was, you know, he was an adult, but he doesn't have much education from what I was told, and he connected certain appliances to solar panels in the house, so I'm thinking if he could do it. And like I said, from what I was told, he's not so academically inclined. I think anybody might be able to do it with a little bit of research and, you know, some guided instruction. There's, you know, the internet now, so you can just about become a surgeon just about, depending on how big you want to go. You know, not saying that you should, but be a surgeon. But certainly make a project out of survival right now, because there are people determined to not only make it where you can't survive in a basic way with utilities, but now, you know, I don't want to banter too much on that one. It's a lot. Another thing I suggest is get a Latin to English dictionary and a Greek to English dictionary. The more I learn, the more I understand that those are two languages that are what American English and British English are made of, along with some other foreign words and words from ancient Africa or El Kabbalah. So you can make a kind of like a scavenger hunt out of word origins and formation. This is a workplace racism story I didn't get to share. I think I want to report a teacher to the State Board of Education, because basically there's a fifth grader I was with who is heavily melanated, very precocious in a great way. He's in special education because he just moves. He's a mover. He has a lot of energy, which means he's also healthy. So he's in special education, and he was mistreated by the technology teacher at a school I subbed at. And I had been with him a couple times and just paying attention, him and other kids, but the way he talked to this young man when he was getting ready to leave the class, he thought he was doing something incorrect, and he chided him about it, and then he kept going. Like it was like he was gnawing on a bone or something. I know it's a simile, but I couldn't help it. Before I knew it, I said, okay, it's done. It's over. Let it go. And then he said something to me, like he was trying to do something. So I said, okay. And if he was, just tell him what you need to tell him and move on. But you're not going to degrade this child in front of me. I said, you must be used to doing it with other people. It's not going to happen in front of me. So then we left. And then this white man, this time a white man, follows us from his classroom to ours and comes in. And I said, what are you doing? He's like, yeah, I came to talk to you. You must want to talk to me. I said, don't do that again, sir. Like, how is this appropriate? So while I was saying that to him, the black security guard starts talking to me. You need to go back in your room. I said, oh, really? I do? I said, you're not going to say nothing to the guy that followed me to my class, though, huh? So long story short, this is at the school. I may have said something about this where they took the Marine Corps, the Rifleman's Creed, and turned it into a school chant for morning meeting, if you could call it that. It's more like morning, you better not F up today meeting. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's really what it is. Like, and so by the end of the day, I went to the principal. She was looking for me. And I put on my recorder. I said, I'm recording this just in case for the district. And I made a mistake, y'all. I said, you got a racist suspect in charge of that technology class. He has no care for these children. I watched him talk to them like animals. And then he talked to this one student like he wasn't even a pet rock. And she's like, well, I disagree. He knows a lot. I said, maybe he knows a lot, but he doesn't know how to deliver it. And I'm telling you once again, he doesn't have any care. He doesn't have any regard. And I said, by the way, you're using the Rifleman's Creed from the Marine Corps to as a chant for children. I said, so what do you think is going to happen if these kids find out what it really is? Or if they see the movie Full Metal Jacket? Have you seen the movie Full Metal Jacket? No, I haven't. I don't want to watch that. I said, but it's okay to recreate a chant that's in that movie and use it for children. I'm like, are we educating or are we raising, training them to be combatants? I said, but then again, based on what I've seen today with this guy, I'm not surprised you have it as the dang creed for the school. But you've been warned. And so she says, I'm going to pull the student in and talk to him. I said, do not do that, please. I was like, if anything, you've been given a legal notice by another educator that there is some type of abuse going on to a student. You need to pull him in with his parents and give him his parents notice. And it really, really bothered me. It really did. And I've been sitting on it for about a week because I was supposed to call in, but I didn't get a chance to because, you know, system at large, at work. But I could use some advice because I really feel like I want to pass go. and not collect $200 and just report it to the dang board because I found something about reporting something for a child that's in special education. If there's a problem, you can make suggestions and also air out what happened that was incorrect. And I'll take some feedback on that. But, you know, listen to me, people, please. School, I know everybody can't do it, but if you can, please homeschool your kids. They're not learning nothing in these schools. They public school and most of the private schools. They're just there for the monetary value that American slave coast situation where they're making money off of black babies. And with that movie, Accounting for Slavery, they're accounting for slavery in these schools. It's all about dollar signs. So many white supremacists in these schools that don't care about children at all. They barely care about their own children. And I'll mute my line. Thank you very much. And
okay. Much obliged, Irie. Which part, I guess, did you feel like it was a mistake saying that there was a suspected racist or race soldier, however you said it? Did you feel like that was the part that you wouldn't do if you had it to do over again?
Yeah, because I've heard on workplace racism, and Mr. Fuller, he said don't mention racism. But I try to be so codified talking to other non-white people that I just call it what it is. So I was talking to a non-white person acting as principal. I just, it came on out, you know what I'm saying? So I think I may have made a mistake because instead of her focusing on the report of verbal abuse in front of other students, she was kind of harping on the racism. So I don't think she's racist though. I was like, well, let's move on. What about the way I'm telling you he talked to this kid? Is that professional? Is that constructive? You know? Yeah.
Mm, I see. Well, you didn't even need our suggestion. That is one of the reasons why my recommendation, for the most part, in the workplace, certainly outside of work, different circumstances, but in the workplace, I generally recommend not branding someone as a racist, because that's exactly what they're going to do. Even if it's almost, even if they call you a dirty nigra, you know, you no count dirty. If they would call them the child, no count dirty nigra coon, and blah, blah, blah. Even then it had to be, you know, and he said he was a dirty no count nigra coon. Is that professional? Is that the way, like, even then, like, I know we're not supposed to say he's a no count dirty nigra coon, but I don't think he's a racist. Now, he's smart and intelligent, and he's well-versed and has an amazing voice. Have you heard him play the cello? Like, man. But that's what does it mean to be white? They are the kings and queens. Because I think he said this is a white woman covering for, caping, as it were, for a white man, race soldier. That's what they all, it doesn't matter what age, doesn't matter Louisiana, Washington State, Cairo, France, doesn't matter. That's what they all do. So for us, I'd say it's just the best we can do. And they still might do the same thing is this professional? Is this the way that we talk to students? And just go.
It was a non-white female.
Okay. My bad. Thanks. Strive for accuracy. Say it again. Non-white female. Well, that's even... Man, that for sure has been my experience over 14 years. Non-white people, we definitely have been trained, conditioned. This white person is not racist. It's got to be something else. He's been great to me. I've never had a... Man, same thing. You have to basically do the same thing. Talk to the students in an unprofessional manner and just go from there. But yeah, that's... I'm very sorry that you had to experience that. And even him coming, that's the same thing that I say to Bay Area mom all the time, because she talks about the same thing with these other staff members, sometimes non-white, being nasty, hostile with her. And so you say something, and then the white fella, white teacher, race soldier, he comes stalking you. I thought you wanted to talk to me. What? What are you doing? He comes, and I think she said even the security officer, who I suspect might have been a non-white person too, he comes in. All right. Josh and Missy, go back to your classroom. It's like, wait a minute. He's stalking me. Wait a minute. Bay Area mom has talked about the exact same thing. And I said, that right there lets you know a lot in terms of how they feel about their non-white students. Look at how they're treating the staff. You're not even being professional with me. Like that, you're stalking me now. It's not even, okay, if you have a concern about how we address the children, we can, you know, maybe meet after class. Go to the teacher's lounge. I'll get you, you know, coffee. Fried chicken even, Black History Month. No, that's not the way they do it. Security card. Bury your mom. She says that all the time. Other non-white staff, even they being discourteous, that's how we've been trained. That's all that's modeled. Very sorry that you had to endure all of that. I do think that is black self-respect in you trying to do the best that you can to, advocate for these young students. I think she said especially melanated, highly melanated young student black male privilege, maybe. And even black self-respect, because that could have been a nasty argument. You go in and make this report and then have a victim. Like, hey, Missy, he is not racist. That is a good white man. Don't be coming in here casting aspersions on our whites. That, like, that could have got real ugly. Like, what? What do you mean? Get him. Composure. We have all been greatly victimized. Sounds like you did a pretty good job, in my opinion. Like, other than, you know, we try to avoid, or at least I think it's best to try to avoid accusing a white person of being racist in the workplace, but do the best you can. Good job, Irie. Incidentally, before we get to the other folks, a few weeks back, Irie told us She said, I don't think she said she was watching Sesame Street. I'm paraphrasing, so I'm going to try to do my best. But anyway, she said that she was thinking about, I'll say it that way, Sesame Street. She said, Big Bird. She said, is that McDonald's? They trying to program us? Like, what's going on? So we can all be fat and obese and eat Big Macs every day, which does happen a lot. They even had that in the report 2 times. And so I told her then, I said, I just did a search. Reading, writing, researching, so important. I just did a search. Sesame Street, McDonald's. There were quite a few reports, and I just told her within a few seconds of her mentioning it. McDonald's was a corporate sponsor of Sesame Street for years. I don't even know how long, because they didn't give exact dates, so who knows? But for years, they didn't even just say a sponsor. They said a corporate sponsor. That's probably millions of dollars. There were other, and they are, I guess, no longer a corporate sponsor because of opposition. People use logic and said, dang, we got all these tubby children and tubby people. Maybe we don't need Cookie Monster. Maybe we don't need McDonald's being a sponsor of Sesame Street. Logic. What other information did they have about the relationship between McDonald's and Sesame Street that even brings up directly racism, white supremacy? I'm reading. Reading is more important than watching television. The book, Kinder Culture, The Corporate Construction of Childhood. On page 81, let's see. Should there not be more recognition of the role played by corporate sponsors who dictate the content of most programs? Once again, Lapham, I think that's it, Lapham, L-A-P-H-A-M, described quite eloquently the expectant PBS courtier who is constantly bowing and smiling in 8 or 9 directions, forever turning like a compass needle in the glare of new money. The public has falsely assumed that children's educational programs are indeed educational and thus good for children. Healy is equally disappointed. If Sesame Street did not purport to be seriously educational, it might pass as clever and colorful light entertainment, but lauded as our major media effort to educate children, I believe it has failed and misled us at a time when we desperately need better models. They talk about the relationship between McDonald's and Sesame Street and many other child-centered programs all throughout this book, Kinder Culture, The Corporate Construction of Childhood. That's the sort of information I would look at and say, well, dang, after you look at all that, maybe Big Bird is supposed to look like the Golden Arches deliberately, and maybe many other aspects. In fact, they even have details about that, like McDonald's, because they have such a long relationship. McDonald's had like little characters and people that Jesus. Anyway, all of that to say, sometimes, as Mr. Fuller has said, the creator sends messages just to you, right? Big Bird looks like the Golden Arches. When that happens, research. Just see. Take a few minutes. Are there any studies, reports, books, anything about this relationship? I can tell you with that one, McDonald's and Sesame Street, there is lots of information. That book, and this book, Kinder Culture, racism comes up specifically. Reading more important than watching television. Much obliged, Irie. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-#. Press *61 if you would like to participate. We actually read Chet Detlinger even mentioned stupid talk, crazy talk by Neil Postman, white man suspected racist who also railed against O.J. Simpson. We talked about that way back when. He also talks about the danger of Sesame Street specifically, and because it purports to be educational, good for children. And he also said, hogwash. I don't think he talks. Oh, that's in his book. Different book. We read Stupid Talk, Crazy Talk, which is great about the importance of words, being accurate with words. He wrote many books. He also wrote Neil Postman, Amusing Ourselves to Death, which is, oh, he has a whole chapter about context in that book. And he also talks about PBS specifically in that one, Amusing, you can tell from the title why he went, Amusing Ourselves to Death. That is a great, I think that was a bestseller, if that sort of thing means anything to you. Anywho, let's see. Other folks who dialed in, let's see. NAB retired firefighter, no sports, no Area 8. Thank you kindly.
Greetings, everyone. My first report is yesterday, a tacky story, which I think is common during this month, but in this case, it was actually kindergarten children who were who had put on blackface during one of their child care sessions. They just showed still pictures. I just saw still pictures of them, and they were dressed up as firefighters. One had on a uniform of a law enforcement officer. There was a couple that was interviewed. It appears that the mom was a non-white black female. It appears that the husband was a white male. And the mother was quite distraught over what she witnessed as far as what her child is involved with in this daycare center. I'm not sure if it was a daycare center or a kindergarten, and even with that, I don't even know what's the big difference of it. All the thing I know that the for the pictures are concerned, they appeared to be toddlers in these pictures. Today, DCS program. Before we, well, we had a field trip today, but before we had a field trip today, I showed them a interview, with Dr., that was, the person that was being interviewed was Dr. Myron Rowe. Showed that from a standpoint of trying to move away from sports to what he's actually doing now. Basically what it was, he basically talked about himself, his lifespan up until this moment, how things transpired, a fight that he got in with where he beat up this 10-year-old white child. He was 10 years old also, for calling him nigger. It went to court. He was afraid that his family, which is from the Bahamas, would get sent back, that sort of thing. And how, what kind of problem that would cause the family, that sort of thing. So, he mentions a whole lot of the things. He first became, interested in becoming a physician from reading a book on Ben Carson when he, and all this, was before he was a teenager. Always had a 4.0 grade point average, while in grade school and in college. Basically just talked about, you know, just about, you know, some of the fine points in his life, the ups and downs, whatever. He is married, to a non-white black female, with four children, double twins, male, female. I thought that was quite interesting. But, anyway, we went to, someone's house. I would just use the phrase that they identified this person, quote unquote, black millionaire. We go every year. And basically what he does, he organizes, other black males of different, professions. And all of them basically witness to these, young fellows about, you know, what they're doing. They put an emphasis on, as alternative to sports. There is so many other things you could be doing. The person, of house that we go to also has a lot of animals in the house and in the yard, that he shows the fellas, that sort of thing. And they get a chance to also jump in the pool. And, that's basically my report for the day. Thanks for listening.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. Great, I guess, share for the young folks. Absolutely. Get them thinking of anything other than white people's ball games. That is outstanding. And even the, I guess, conflict, because there's so many of those, and those are so common even right now, so that they can be thinking like, wow, these things can escalate quickly into something really serious. Wow. Keep that sort of thing in mind. What do we do? What's the best thing to do? How can we avoid that sort of thing? Like, yes, because these sort of skirmishes, 5 minutes, we got that whole program, 5 minutes. Yes, you too can end up in that sort of situation. So always important to be talking to young non-white people, and maybe not so young non-white people, about the best way to handle those situations. Sometimes they can happen so quickly and not paying attention, and can be exacerbated if you are under the influence. Maybe you're with a lot of people who are under the influence at a party or club, bar, or whatever it is. With other non-white people who do not understand racism, white supremacy, and or if you yourself are confused about white supremacy, racism, might not make the smartest decisions. So lots of variables. And then all of that, making sure we are talking to young people, those of us who have offspring, talking to them about all of that. Yes, very, very dangerous out here. Sobriety would be best. Let us see. Number is 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. We'll see if other folks, if they are spectating in preparation for the big Super Bowl shindig tomorrow. I can only tell you the culture of all of this. I know people might say, oh, exciting, it's just fun, it's entertainment. It is white supremacy through and through, but the culture of all that. You sit around and have all these reports where they talk, got to talk every day. The sad standard American diet is so bad, so full of toxins and MSG and all the rest of it, high fructose corn syrup and all the rest of it. All these people suffering, even children suffering childhood obesity and heart disease and all the rest of it. Why not? As opposed to promoting all that cheese and pizza and buffalo wings and potato chips and beer and brain damage and prescription drugs, old Brett Favre. Why not do something else? Take a field trip. That's what retired firefighter and them said. I said, if the weather is the same as it was today, here in Seattle, down there in South Florida, they always got nice weather. Never rains in Southern California either. Get outside, man. Be stuck inside. It's a reason they pay millions of dollars, maybe even billions now, for all those commercials. Brain computer. Trash your brain computer. Yes, you want to eat hot dogs for the next 25 years. All that processed foods. You can have some cancer, diabetes. Yes, you want to eat soda. They said that. The report that I played about the access, the content right with that Kinder Culture book that I mentioned. They said that. I played that the YouTube, young YouTube content promoting children. Yay, let's go find the M&Ms. Yay, let's go find the soda. That's all day tomorrow. That's all day tomorrow. That's all it is. Pizza, potato chips, Doritos. Soda, beer mostly, but yeah, we got to get, you know, Coca-Cola and all that in there too. No reason to participate in any of that, especially system of white supremacy, racism. We have more important priorities. Doing my part, as I said, we will be here, white guest, talking about brain and specifically racism, white supremacy. Brain damage and all of this tackle football. Looking forward. Incidentally, in that segment also, there were two separate. The first report, not the one where they were talking about the YouTube content and how they target all that malnourishing, poisonous content at young children. Probably a lot of young children. See, now that, again, that wasn't even my point, but that, once again, if you have young people, we had victims, they dialed in and said, dang, just got, you know, newborn in the family and all that. Or, well, still a newborn, but I mean, they're one, you know, they had their first birthday. And family member got them an iPhone at one. Like, who are they texting at one? I said, you're going to have offspring. No TV in the house. I don't have children. I would not have my 2-year-old, 3-year-old, 4-year-old, 5-year-old, 6-year-old. They do not need a tablet. For what? They certainly do not need a cell phone. You got to be joking. They will have more than enough time to do all the swiping and sitting and all of that stuff. It's not even healthy, all of the sitting and swiping and viewing that we do, the big people. So why start them out at 1, 2, 3? Now, that does mean you probably have to do a little bit more playing with them and paying attention to them. But that is one of the worst, to just toss that device. And I can empathize. Let me say it that way. I do not have children. But that's it. I can totally empathize. Being stressed, you have to work and all the rest of it. You try and breastfeed. You want to eat healthy. You want to sleep and all the rest. You have a billion things. You're being terrorized all the time. We do not have a community on the plantation, so I get it. But, man, dropping that phone off in their lap or dropping that tablet off, plopping them down in front of the television, especially you got one of those big, you know, giant 9-foot screens now, and you just sit them down in front of that and they can just watch whatever they want. Ooh-wee. That is about the war. That's about as far from counter-racist parenting as you can get. Whitey wins again on that, because we're going to just destroy their brain computer, have them all addicted to white people and filled with anti-blackness and filled with M&Ms and Coca-Cola and Sprite and Taco Bell and McDonald's and chicken nuggets. You can get them all kinds of ways. Super Bowl, oh yeah, give me a Brett Favre jersey too. Do not have your children in front of, around, none of that. Not at the Super Bowl party, none of that. Let us see. Other folks who dialed in. I mentioned, make sure I was not lying on our Bay Area mom, even though I did mention her a few times in talking to Irie. Bay Area mom should be with us as well.
Hi. You weren't lying on me. Thank you. I wanted to, I did listen to the clip with the babies, and they are giving the children, they are being babysat by technology, a lot of it. As parents, I think they believe it's safe because it's in a cartoon form or child-like Pee Wee Herman form. I say that because they have, like, Blippi and other adult content creators that do childlike things and for the child's attention. I know someone whose grandparents gave the six-month-old an iPhone because they said the baby needed something in her hand. The brother of this baby, the mom does it, she gets mad at me, but the brother of this baby is 5 years old, and they're already labeling him violent at the white school the mom thought would be wonderful to send this child to coming from a black preschool. He has the tablet. He has an iTablet or whatever the tablet by Macintosh or the Mac version. So he broke it because he got out. And, of course, mom went and fixed the screen or replaced it or however, because we need these gadgets to babysit or to keep the children preoccupied, because we don't really have time for the children that we produced. It's as if they were produced for another purpose because we don't have time to develop them. Miss Lorne Cress Love, we were talking about her on Thursday. I just wanted to send my condolences. She was wonderful. She was wonderful coming on the program after her sister transitioned to just make sure that we stayed at task and not so much in sorrow. And I appreciate that. Even in the Institute, she would come and participate with us. So I just wanted to share appreciation for the time that she spent trying to replace the system with the system of justice all the way until the end. She never stopped. We were listening to a clip of her speaking after the January 6th terrorists, when they forced themselves into the White House. So she was very strong speaking then. So I just appreciate her work, her family, and that's all. Thank you.
Without sorrow, without sorrow. I said, man, dedicated to the assignment through and through. Everybody, Dr. Welsing, Lorne Cress Love, forgot the other sister getting victim of racism. Whole family, really, dedicated to the task. Replace white supremacy with justice. Just a really outstanding illustration of that. Without sorrow. Much obliged, Bay Area mom. Number again, 605-313-5164. Hey, the six-month-old, they got the phone. They can call in. See? 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to to participate. They got pacifiers still. Or maybe they don't make those. Anyway, is that, that's antiquated? They don't make pacifiers anymore? It's got to be a phone. I don't have children. Anyway, I do think I have seen a pacifier, though. I have been around some newborns, like in the past 2-3 years, and I think I have seen a pacifier. I don't know. Maybe they got a time capsule or somewhere and preserved that from a long ago era. Anyway, the point that I even was trying to make when I brought up the, they said, doctor issue, they were going to bring health officials to churches to serve black people, which I don't have a problem with. In fact, I said, dang, I did just read about the barbershop element of that study that was in the CPR report. We talked about that last month, and they were talking about CPR. They could do the same thing with CPR, go to barbershops and what have you and teach CPR. And it's like, or churches and teach CPR. That would help address the problem we talked about before. Anyway, in that segment, they said that the doctors, white, do not display cultural sensitivity. And they went on to explain that a black patient will come in and they don't get the same amount of time with a white doctor that a white patient would get. That's not a lack of cultural sensitivity. Well, that's not a lack of cultural sensitivity. That is the practice of white supremacy racism. That's, once again, we do not just say white people practice racism, period. That's what it is. It's not that they're ignorant, they're not naive, they're not unconscious. They practice racism. It's got to be all this obfuscating. Accelerationist, radical, extremist, right-wing, culturally insensitive, culturally unaware. They got lots of way. Or lack of cultural awareness. They got lots of way. So you mean this white person is racist? They didn't even say that about Sarah Beth Clendaniel. They said she was a neo-Nazi. What does that mean? White supremacist racist. She's a race soldier. Now get on out of here. She should, instead of the bucket list, she's just gone and kick the bucket. She didn't want to be even a trifling, no-count white mother and take care of your offspring. You didn't want to go and terrorize black people in Baltimore. Come on in. You heard Baltimore several times. We began and ended exactly with infrastructure. They started off talking about no water supply for places like Baltimore, Freddie Gray, and then end with infrastructure. Other folks who dialed in with a hand up, if you have commentary, proceed. Our caller at the courthouse should be with us also.
May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Greetings to Gus, the host, the listeners and callers. I was thinking about that, too, about the segment with, I think that was the mother of the suspected white supremacist white woman. And it looked like she was, or it sounded like she was responding, I guess I could say with caution or just being, I guess, preemptive or whatever, careful with the words she was choosing, saying that she admitted to being aware of, I guess she was trying to say her belief. But we just didn't have the same belief or whatever. And I'm trying to think of what that could mean as well. Like, did she also have, I guess with her term, believe in racism? She never really even mentioned that necessarily. You know, she just said that she knew about it. And given that she went to, I guess, like a court hearing or saying that she was going to be focused on getting custody of her children, I'm thinking, shouldn't the DCF have gotten like a court case petition against her or something? If her mother was informed about her having those kinds of views. That's one thing I was thinking as well. And then I noticed that, and she was asked about, well, do you think that your daughter is a neo-Nazi, and do you think she's that? And raising the pitch of his voice, like, come on, she couldn't be this way. That's what I'm thinking. Like, that's how I heard it. And he, after he said, I cannot remember the term to use after neo-Nazi. And she only responded to what he asked after that. If you go back and listen to that, and she didn't, and it sounded like to me that like she didn't directly respond to that, even though that's not direct, as in saying, is she a white supremacist? The segment where I think that's up in Philadelphia, the young white racist teen females, I think that's the one where they spray painted the other white girl face or something like that and said that she's going to do my laundry or something. You know, once again, white people are not ignorant about racism, and they use that cliche type of response of, we don't tolerate we don't have these kinds of views in our community or in our school or something, and they cover up the faces, but when it's black children that get in trouble, I've noticed at times, at least in my area locally, they don't do that necessarily. And just like having a mugshot, you know, I know I use the word like, but that's a crime just like that. So why not have their face exposed, like show who they are? But that's also going along with the racism. So, yeah, that was calculated. They knew what they were doing. And I think it was another school like over in California where maybe it was like a year ago or something. They were wearing Nazi swastikas and the, you know, things from the history of what the Germans and Adolf Hitler. And, you know, I'm thinking about that term as well, about transnational white supremacy or something. And it's words I'm going to have to start writing down myself and researching. But, yeah, those are very interesting and insightful audio segments, as usual. And thank you for the broadcast and for allowing me to share. And that's all I have to say.
Much obliged, caller in Florida. Man, that number one method white people use to practice racism, white supremacy, being deceptive with words. Wow. They have been cranking them out. I'd never heard that one either. Accelerationist, that is a newer one that I've only heard about in the last 30 days or so. And then transnational white supremacist. And they even defined it. Some white person outside our U.S. borders practicing white supremacy racism within doing nefarious activities online or however to cause disruptions within the sovereign U.S. Dang. Even when if it's going to be defined that way, I could use that term. We got some transnational white supremacists meddling it. In fact, I think I even heard that term before, but it was a different definition. It was slightly different. It was transnational white supremacy, but they were talking about the connection between Brazil, January 6th and January 8th in Brazil. They were talking about the connection between those two so-called countries and how they are transnational white supremacy, exchanging ideas, views, information. How do we practice racism? How do we control it? How do you control your Negroes? How do you control your Negroes? Man, global system of white supremacy racism. Speaking of global, man, the earthquake in Turkey. I looked at the report. I think I saw one from maybe a day or so ago, and they said suspected 13,000 people died, which is a lot. I was stunned then. I looked today, this morning, and they said, oh, 25,000 people reportedly dead. I was stunned. Like, what the, what? 25,000, like, that is huge. In one swoop, like, from, like, what in the world? Then I said, okay, let's see. Are these white people not, I'm ignorant, I've never been to Turkey, I don't even know. Are these white people, are these non-white people? I start looking at pictures of, you know, who are they? People have seen this, I hope, right? I mean, everything in Turkey, they've been talking about this in the news and what have you. Now, I don't know if this is the same type of news coverage, if this was Australia, France, London, Germany, we just mentioned them, here, Canada. I don't know if it'd be the same type of attention as opposed to Turkey. And like I said, are these people classified as white, non-white? Pictures that I looked at just from going over it today, I think a lot of these folks are not white. I don't think the most powerful individuals classified as white, I do not think they would be accepted as white. Maybe if they could get to Brazil, maybe. I don't know. Either way, that is stunning. For that many people to die in 25, I mean, I don't even have scale. For that many people to die in one swoop from, you know, a natural disaster. I mean, that's like atomic bomb or some type of event. I mean, that is just staggering. Anybody, have they paid attention? If you have not, that's fine. But that's another reason the great Dr. Francis Cress Welsing encouraged. Study the news locally, nationally, globally, because the system of white supremacy racism is global. But that is one, like, have people watched that? That's the sort of thing that I would ask Mr. Fuller, too, like, because, yeah, did you see that? Are these individuals not white? But did anybody, has anybody been paying attention? The earthquake, do you non-white, white people in Turkey, have you been able to gauge just from the news coverage? If folks haven't been paying attention, that's fine, too. That'll give people something that they can kind of be mindful of heading into the new week.
I have. Sadly, I don't have words, and I don't even know if I can conjure enough emotion to feel bad for those people, because not only did this happen, but they've been under, like, repeated attacks. There's like a proxy war going on in Syria and Turkey. The United States has, you know, the culprit, of course, destabilizing those countries as it is. And so there were like several like attacks, you know, throughout the decade. And when this happens, like they weren't fit to be able to respond to something like this at all.
Do you think the people are classified as white or non-white, the bulk of the victims, the folks that you've been seeing?
Well, they're not white to me. And based on the behavior of the United States military, they're not white. But then because of the racial classification confusion, as far as I've been told, anyone of Middle Eastern descent can come over and be classified as white once they arrive in America. So my final answer is, politically, I don't know. But ethnically, I would say, yes, they are not white.
Got it. Always respecting, I don't know. Particularly with racial classification confusion, because, man, they can switch it up on you. And in fact, we just heard the report. They were talking about that exactly for the census and saying, oh, we're going to make a change. And exactly what she just said, accurate. Middle Eastern is white. And Moses said, wait a minute now. This, I don't know, this on paper and how this operates does not match up. they might be saying the same thing, that, hey, on paper you're saying that I'm white, but, yeah, going around like you, the military, they got the bayonets pointed, y'all are treating us like the sand niggers. Yeah. Like that, I mean, man, that's what I thought. That's what I thought. Like, I recognize the nigga, the Katrina, I'm very familiar. I'm very familiar. That's what it, and like I said, even the coverage, like, man, if 25,000 white people in Australia, man, fuck that Super Bowl. But that's what it would be. 25,000 white people. They could be in No Count, West Virginia, man. Like, man, we are going to have the whole Super Bowl that's dedicated about this and blah, blah, blah. It'd have been 25,000 white people in Canada. Man, everything. We are pausing Black History Month and at 25. I mean, that is, I can't even think of another event where 25,000 people died in one swoop. I cannot think. That's not Hurricane Katrina. That's no event I can think of. You know, hey, I'm still learning. Victim of racism, so it could be No Count brain that I forgot or what have you. But that is, I mean, as she said, the magnitude of that, I don't even have the words to articulate. And it's relegated. And yeah, sad. Ready for that Super Bowl. Get that pizza and buffalo wings. Like, are you serious? Any other, have you all been, you know, seeing reports about this? Do you think white people in a racial classification? I struggle with that too. So if you're not sure, no problem. That'll give us all. We can pay attention, you know, this coming week. Hopefully they'll be talking about this and we can kind of, you know, suss it out. See, are they white? Not white. Other folks, have you all been paying attention? If you haven't been paying attention, that's fine too. Anybody else? Have you been seeing the, paying attention to the earthquake before we get ready to wrap up? Maybe not. That'll be something we can be mindful about as we move forward in the week, making sure.
Can I be heard?
Retired firefighter, yes, sir.
My observation as far as the location would be, I don't know. I would say, and it probably would happen, that some of those survivors would somehow find their way in the northwestern hemisphere, and then they would be white once they come in this part of the world. That's it.
One more time. Always respecting. I don't know. Particularly on this one, since none of us, since I think all of us victims of racism, non-white people, we are not in charge of racial classifications. So, hey, the most powerful white people, they will come make a decision and maybe they'll let us know. So we will, you know, not be confused about this. But, that also, I think the last part of what retired firefighter said, like, hey, if they're able to come to this part of the world, that might help us understand that. If they get to come over here and get set up, they get the nice disaster relief package, opposite of what happened for the Negroes down in the Ninth Ward and what have you. They get hooked up and get on their feet. They get to put all these nice documentaries and TikTok videos together. Like, oh, man, it was devastation, all the deaths. Man, we came up, man. We came, got Super Bowl jerseys and everything. Like, oh, okay, I got it. We will pay attention, but man, that is, I don't have words. Like, they have earthquakes here, right? They had the earthquake in California and some others. I do not ever remember an earthquake where 25,000 people died. Jesus. Yes, watch that. Way more important than the Super Bowl. No contest. Anywho. We will be here tomorrow, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Whew. Alternative to the game. I think it might be halftime. So, you know, I guess you could do whatever for the first half and then lock racism, brain damage, neuroscience tomorrow. Beautiful timing. Ah, can't wait. We're here Monday as well, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Invest if you think the cows is constructive. Listener supported for 14 years. Visit the blog racism-notes.blogspot.com. racism-notes.blogspot.com. PayPal button is in the top right corner. You'll see the links for Venmo, Cash App, and PayPal. The Cash App address, cash.app/$ the cows. Enormous gratitude to all the listeners who have nabbed items, invested over the years. Hopefully we have been worthy of your time and energy. Hopefully we have been accurate more often than not with our counter-racist suggestions and views. With that, particularly for this weekend, man, the white guest for Monday, when I suggested that date, which is the 13th of February, it wasn't, ooh, 13 is unlucky, ooh, it was, I don't know. That's the day after the brain damage bowl. You think people will be hungover? They might not be able to process what we're talking about. That. Football culture? White culture. Accurate, too. Absolutely accurate. We had a victim in New Jersey. He said yesterday, he said they had to bribe employees. Hey, you got to be here on Monday. This is serious. We're docking pay. We're taking toll. You are going to be here. I don't care what happens. I don't care. The Eagles get blown out by 50. You are going to be here on Monday. I don't care what you lose. The Chiefs go out there and stink it up. They have some other drunkards on staff and they've ran over all the children. That's on you. You are going to be here on Monday. We're going to have lunch. It'll be catered, but you are going to be here. And you better not be drunk. That is embarrassing to have that. That's across the land. That's what we can look forward to on Monday, having surly, drunk, hungover colleagues. White ball. Dr. Welsing said they're not getting rid of guns and they're not getting rid of white ball games. Sobriety would be best. Keep your children away from the screens tomorrow. Man, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Lorne Cress Love, thank you so much for just being an amazing illustration, just like your sister, in your own individual way, an amazing illustration of dedication to counter racism and our assignment. Solve the problem. Lorne Cress Love, not forgotten. No name calling, no gossiping. Reading, she endorsed, man, I heard that one before. Lorne Cress Love came here repeatedly and said the same thing. Reading is more important than watching television. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Man, I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.